This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
It's go time. Let's do this.
This is what you can look forward to on episode 121 of Skywalking Through Neverland.
Just nod your head if you have some juicy information.
I'm nodding as fast as I can.
The number one request was put an item limit on purchases at the Star Wars Celebration store.
Eliza, did Dave Filoni let you wear his hat?
What's your number sign?
Just to let you know that Easter bunnies in Florida are called hoojips.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Hello, Skywalkers.
Baby, you listen.
Off to Neverland.
I only hope that we never lose sight of one thing, that it was all started by a mountain.
You are skywalking through Neverland.
Hey, Skywalkers. Thank you for joining us on Skywalking Through Neverland. And welcome to our family of Skywalkers out there who are joining us, whether this is your first time or your 121st time. So thanks for joining us on our adventure through fandom. Now I am Richard. I like that too. I am Richard, and now everyone please say hello to my sweetie wife Sarah, who is just getting over her grief at the loss of Disney Infinity.
Oh, you know what? I haven't played it since the announcement. It's like too sad. I can't like bear to play it, but I have been sharing photos of my Disney Infinity figures, which is half the fun for me. I really like taking the photos and being all artsy with them. So, and if you noticed on episode 120, I used my sadness figure as the main figure, and she was all sad.
Well, it's an avenue to get over your grief.
It's true. It's true. But let's look ahead. Let's look forward and say hello to all our Star Wars and Disney fans. And really, thank you so much for supporting this show. Throughout all social media, whether you're watching on Periscope today as our Scope Walkers, or
I wanted to say that because every week I keep messing it up.
Oh,
so in my head I had Scope Walker, Scope Walker, Scope Walker.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Did I take that away from you?
We'll do it on 122.
Okay. Well, everyone who's watching now or who is listening now, you are officially part of the Skywalker family. You are Skywalkers. And we love it when you tweet at us during the show. So please tweet at us at SkywalkingPod. You will be a Tweetwalker. And I see lots of hearts on Periscope here. So thank you guys. Wow. I know you guys are all Tweetwalkers and Scopewalkers.
It's like Valentine's Day on Periscope.
Oh, look at that. Oh, they're so pretty.
It's a waterfall of hearts.
I know. Look, it's blue and teal and purple. And
what does the blue
red
heart mean?
No, I think it's people. Different people get you. Gotcha. You're assigned different colors once you join a Periscope.
All right.
It's a love fest. Yes, it is. Wow. That's
all right.
Exciting.
Let's move on here because we got a huge show. Now, we are recording this from Long Beach, California on May 24th, 2016, or as I call it, Star Wars Day Eve.
Oh, that's right.
Because tomorrow, for first generation fans like myself, May 25th is Star Wars Day.
Right.
And if you notice on the Star Wars calendar,
ooh,
here we go. Who did we see over there? Who are those little white furry characters?
Oh, look.
See?
Look
May
24th. Look at them. Look at the little Miz. The little hoojibs.
On the Star Wars day-to-day calendar, they're showing the picture of the last Marvel comic, 107, and there's the gang, Luke, Han, Leia, 3PO, and hoojibs.
Hoojibs.
And R2.
Wow.
All right. Cool
that calendar has the Star Wars Marvel comic covers.
I love it.
We haven't got to... What? Is Leia wearing a green dress?
Looks like Ginger from Gilligan's Island. And there's Chewbacca.
Oh my goodness.
And as we can tell, he hasn't really gotten any better artistically,
no,
since issue number 3.
Oh, well. All right. Well, should we tell everyone what's coming up on this episode, though?
Please. Start us off.
Oh, me? Okay. I get to go. So coming up on this episode, we can never start too early. We are starting to prepare for Celebration Orlando.
Can't wait.
I know. Now it's only 11 months away, and already we feel like we're behind.
Yeah, we're way behind in planning. We have so much in store, which you're going to find out in just a little bit.
Yes. Yes. So Trisha Barr, my co-host on Fangirls Going Rogue, Rick Peralta from lineingup.net, and his daughter Eliza Peralta, who's 8 years old, and also the Chopper Secret Keeper, they are joining us this week as we discuss what we're all looking forward to and the number of meetups already planned.
Now, when we record at Disney Springs, mm-hmm. everyone bring your running shoes. So we'll need to dodge the security.
Outrun security.
The mall police.
That's funny.
Yeah, so bring your walkie-talkies, grappling hooks, and running shoes.
All right. And what else is on this week's episode?
Well, you've seen him as the warm-up host at Star Wars Celebration, Star Wars Weekends, and the Star Wars Dark Side Marathon. But now you can see Mark Daniel as the co-host for Inside Disney Parks.
Yeah, it's a new Disney YouTube show. So he's going to be on to tell us about that kind of behind the scenes and also what you can look forward to at Star Wars Celebration Europe because he will be there along with DJ Elliot.
And he's got some inside scoops. Mm-hmm. Now, Drew Kaplan, the Skywalking book analyst... I love that title. He's also back to give us his thoughts on the Star Wars Character Encyclopedia and Star Wars The Force Awakens Incredible Cross-Sections book from DK Publishing.
That's right. Oh, Skywalking book analyst, we're going to ask you, Skywalkers, for maybe another fun name for him because he's going to be on to
review the books review that the books. DK Publishing has been giving us.
Yeah. Yeah.
So big shout out to DK Publishing, mm-hmm. but I kind of like Skywalking book analyst.
Yeah.
What do you guys think? Periscopers, yeah. what do you say about that?
Yeah.
All right, let us know as we continue. Now, we also have shout-outs, Skywalker of the Week, and...
Things we want to share. Things we want to share. Things we want to share.
And do mind your step.
You're back.
What's the matter?
The Hatter's the matter.
We need you to save the Hatter, or Wonderland will be history.
Alice was here?
The Alice.
This cannot be good.
Now, let me go first with this one, just okay. So we can end on a high note with what you have to share.
Okay, sounds good.
So we saw a media screening of Alice Through the Looking Glass, which yes. opens on May 27th. And this time it's not directed by Tim Burton, who directed the first film, mm-mm. but it's directed by James Bobin from Muppets Most Wanted.
Okay.
So I was really looking forward to this film and had very high hopes, but unfortunately, it's a great departure from the fun and excitement of the original film.
Yeah, so we no spoilers here?
No, nothing big.
Nothing big.
Nothing. No yeah. big plot twists.
Plus, this is technically based on a novel, so...
Yeah.
Yeah. So, we're not going to tell you the ending. Just FYI.
Right. Okay. Now, when I see an Alice in Wonderland film, I want to see the little girl lost in a fanatical world full of Lewis Carroll and Tim Burton characters. Mm-hmm. I don't want to see a world full of Michael Bay and Hasbro characters. We'll get into that in a second.
Yes.
Now... In this film, in case you don't know, Alice slips through the looking glass and finds herself back in Underland with the White Queen, the Cheshire Cat, the White Rabbit, and the very freaky Tweedledee and Tweedledum. Mm-hmm. And her friends tell her that the Mad Hatter is depressed over the death of his family. Hoping to save his loved ones, Alice steals the Chronosphere from the character of Time to travel into the past. While there, she encounters the younger Hatter and the evil Red Queen. Mm-hmm. This film is anything but fun.
Aww. Well, okay, let me preface this by saying, if you love costume design and makeup and hair, you might really like this movie. It really is beautiful to look at.
It already sounds complicated.
I know.
Well, yes.
It
yes.
is true.
So all the whimsy and fun of the first film... out the window.
Yeah, yeah. So it's beautiful to look at. The problem is it's almost too pretty to look at and it's distracting.
Yeah.
Like for me, we watched it in IMAX 3D because that's just what the screening was. And I actually don't recommend that because everyone's like makeup was so crystal clear. You're like looking at why the Mad Hatter has two different colors on two of his eyes and why there's like zebra stripes under his eyes.
And even and the you're imperfections.
Not, right. And then you're not like listening to what they're saying because you're so engrossed. And then like there's this fabric that Alice wears. It's really cool. And I was just all engrossed in her dress and I had no idea what the plot and the plot is already complicated. So like I didn't
so
know
if,
what was
if you
going
tune
on.
Out for a second to look at
yes.
the makeup,
yeah.
you're gone. You're
yeah.
out of here.
Yeah.
Now, not having read the book, which this film is based, I am looking at this film coming off of the 2010 Alice in Wonderland
right.
film. Now, Alice is now a sea captain,
mm-hmm.
and she's able to pull off these Han Solo-type moves to escape attacking pirate ships. This is in the intro.
Right.
So already she's being set up as not the little girl lost, like
right.
we had in the last film.
But a take-charge woman.
Which really served as the point of view of the audience. So we could see what's going on in Wonderland through her point
through
of
her
view.
Eyes, right.
Because she was just so full of wonderment. This time, I had a hard time finding a character to be the point of view.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time I found it, the movie was over.
Okay.
And I still didn't really find it.
yeah. No, so, okay, Mrs. Reb W. asked, this is based on the second book. It, honestly, it's based on the second book in the title.
In the title only.
And the fact that she goes through a mirror, and that's pretty much it. All the rest is, like, pretty, it's, like, completely kind of its own story.
Yeah.
And time, I actually don't know if that's part of the novel, but he was an interesting character to me. Like, I liked his inclusion, And the fact that it's so kind of weird and topsy-turvy kind of a character. But once again, the plot just gets in the way because it was very complicated.
What was distracting, going on a tangential point,
uh-huh.
is that the Monkees have a song called Through the Looking Glass.
Oh.
So that song was running through my head through the whole film, and that was really the only saving grace of the whole film.
I reach out to hold you, but it's just your reflection.
Now, Helena Bonham Carter, she saves the film by giving it a sense of humor as the Red Queen.
Okay.
Something that Johnny Depp could not accomplish as this very tired Mad Hatter.
He was creepy looking, you guys.
Yeah, but he wasn't fun. He wasn't fun and whimsical
no.
and mischievous.
He was not mischievous
like in their first film.
Right.
And Anne Hathaway walked through a couple of scenes and did something.
She kind of did the princess thing.
Yeah.
She wandered around.
I'm not even really sure why she was there.
With princess hair.
Sacha Baron Cohen is another saving grace as
mm-hmm.
his portrayal of time, like you just mentioned. And
I agree.
If this film were any better, his character would be a big hit, but he just got buried in the art direction and the costume design.
Yeah, as did most of these characters, yes.
Yeah, but especially him. And I could really see that character screaming to get out, but he having to act against all these digital effects,
mm-hmm.
some of his character design was a digital effect. I think that was really heavy on Sacha Baron Cohen, who was a fantastic actor. Just in this, he did as much as he could.
Mm-hmm.
Then there were these Transformer-looking creatures. There's where the Michael Bay and Hasbro part comes in. I don't know why they were there, but...
Well, they were seconds and minutes.
Really?
Yeah. They were his seconds,
oh.
the little guys, and then they transformed into minutes, which were bigger, basically.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
I think that's when I was listening to the Monkees in my head.
Oh,
so,
you must have been.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. If this movie were called anything but Alice in Wonderland,
mm-hmm.
it would probably be good. Still convoluted, but somewhat good.
Okay.
Now, I would say the best moment came at the dedication to Alan Rickman, who voiced the character of Absalom, the blue butterfly.
Yeah.
And there were some pretty audible sighs and sniffs
yeah.
and sniffles in the audience.
I know for me, I was listening. I was like, oh, man, that was like the one moment in the film that really got to me. And yeah.
To Optimus Times. Who said that?
Tatooine.
Optimus
like
Time.
It.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Being cool looking creature, those big Hasbro looking Transformers.
Yes.
They just didn't fit in this movie.
I guess not.
Well,
it was very steampunk.
It's very steampunk. It's very dark.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you my. Can I give one good thing about this film?
Did you also hear the monkeys in your head too?
No, I didn't. I didn't know what song you were talking about. But I did want to mention that once it finally got to the message of the film, after a whole bunch of convoluted plot, it actually was a good message. So, you know, I really enjoyed that. I won't tell it here, but I did like how it actually everything did finally come together towards the end to give you, you know, you learn.
And finally, Anne Hathaway had a purpose.
Yeah, exactly. And honestly, a lot of the emotional crux of the film was on the Red Queen.
Yeah, she is. It should have been called Red Queen. That's it. That's all you need to know. The Red Queen, because she was, for some reason, I've always had this thing against Helena Bonham Carter. I don't know why. Okay. I don't know how that started, but never really just didn't like her as an actress. Mm-hmm. Then when I saw her more and more as Bellatrix from Harry Potter,
yes,
I started to grow more fond of her and respected her as an actress. Now when I see her in a movie, it's like, I want to see this. She's really good.
Nice.
She just does such a big array of characters that I think she can handle anything from drama to genre. So way to go. She needs a Red Queen spinoff now.
Well, you know what she needs? She needs a Disney Infinity figure.
Not gonna happen.
I know it's not gonna happen, but I was just at Target this morning, and today was the release of the new Alice in Wonderland figures, and there's an Alice figure, there's a Time figure, and there's a really creepy looking Mad Hatter figure, and I was looking at them. Time looks pretty cool, but how cool would it be to have the Red Queen figure and have her lop off people's heads in the game? I think that would be awesome.
Do you need to lay down?
No. Yeah.
Well, between this film not doing well and Disney Infinity gone, these characters in Target will collect a lot of dust.
Yeah.
Pretty much, if you buy a Snickers bar, you get 3 free Disney Infinity characters. That's what my prediction is.
Oh.
Now, speaking of predictions, I just can't see this film doing well because it's not getting good reviews anywhere.
No.
So Disney really should stick with the March release dates, which is when Alice was released and Return to Oz,
the Great and Powerful.
They did very, very well. Mm-hmm. Now, last year, they released Tomorrowland on the Memorial Day weekend.
They did.
Tanked. This is gonna tank. Maybe just stay away from this weekend. Not for you. All right. Now, let's end on a high note.
Okay.
What do you want to share?
I want to share that, Richard, you and I got to attend the Warner Brothers Studio Tour, a press event in Burbank, California. Now, the tour, it's been updated and expanded with a new exhibit called DC Universe, The Exhibit.
Yeah. Last year, they were celebrating Batman's 75th anniversary, which never got to see. So now it's been updated with the whole DC universe.
Yeah, and it features costumes from Batman v Superman.
Right.
And the upcoming Suicide Squad. And these are actual costumes worn by the actors. So Batman has Ben Affleck sweat.
Yeah, and by the Superman's cape made out of wool.
Yeah, it was really interesting to get up close.
Poor Henry Cavill.
And you can get like right up close. So we were like touching the cape. All of a sudden someone... Please don't touch the costumes.
Yeah,
you know.
It doesn't say not to touch them, so if it doesn't say not to touch them, I want to touch these fabrics.
Yeah, yeah.
And even after the 5th time they said don't touch the fabrics, how do you get that close and not want to touch Gal Gadot's pieces?
My mom made a funny comment on one of those Gal Gadot's photos of the...
Wonder Woman.
She says, if I try that on, will I get that body? That was cute.
Now, the whole event was really... circled around Suicide Squad, which is coming out this August.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the main focus. And sitting right in the middle of the room was Harley Quinn in her little hot pants short shorts.
Yeah. Holy buckets. So you're going to see a lot of that actress in the movie.
Yeah, a lot. Margot Robbie, good job.
All right. Well, we were there on May 18th to check out this new edition, and we're really surprised we saw Gene Simmons wandering around the floor with his entourage.
Yeah.
Like, Richard was like, that's Gene Simmons over there. Like, oh, yes, it is. He's very tall.
He came in there as a comic book fan.
He did, yeah. And it turns out that he was actually a surprise guest to announce the exhibit. And so he made a short speech, and here's my favorite part.
Hi, everybody. The great thing about what Warner Brothers and DC have done is to show everybody that the geeks have finally won.
Yeah. It's our world. Now you all just live in it.
the geeks have finally won back in 2008 when Iron Man had debuted. And that was really that was really the start of, hey, you know what? We're the geeks. We're taking over.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah, I really enjoyed that moment. And I know all the press were like gathered around jockeying for position, trying to get video. Richard, you were nice enough to take my camera from me and get video up higher because I'm short.
And I got a chance to talk to him for a couple of seconds. And that was a lot of fun because I even had a doll of him when I was a kid.
Oh, really?
So it was really fun. Now seeing him, and he gave a fist bump.
Oh, yay. Yeah, and I got a picture of that moment, so that was pretty cool. Yes. And Tatooine Breeze says, the geek shall inherit the Earth on Periscope. Yes.
Done and done.
I know. Now, while we were there, we were told that we could interview anyone with a blue wristband. So we found Christopher. And yeah, he gave us some great info on this tour. In fact, when we arrived, we didn't know that this was part of the Warner Brothers tour. So let's listen in to this interview with Christopher, and he'll give us some more knowledge and details about this. All right, we're here at Warner Brothers Studios at the DC Universe exhibit, superheroes and supervillains.
And now we're here with Christopher, who wants to tell us all about it in length.
Hey, how's it going, guys? Oh, this whole DC Universe world. This gives you props and costumes from our previous movie, Batman vs. Superman, and our upcoming movie, Suicide Squad.
Wow. All right, so we're looking around here, but first when you walk in, you see some very expensive first edition comics right here.
Absolutely. That's straight from the DC archives. Each issue is the very first issue printed for each respectable comic book character.
Wow.
Expect to see more armed guards with a Superman number one sitting over there.
Yeah, don't worry. We got cameras all over the place and laser guns to use aiming. So if you come within, I don't know, 2 inches of the comic book, you might not like the outcome.
All that's standing between me and Superman number one is a third of a sheet of plexiglass. And suddenly we're 1.5 millionaires. Not saying we're going to do it at all. But I'm just saying, if we do it, you know nothing about this. All right, so what else are we looking at over here?
Well, as you can tell from the first thing you guys see after the comic books is the exact costume that Henry Cavill wore in Batman vs. Superman. And to the right, you have Miss Lois Lane and Clark Kent's uniforms. And on the other side, you have the costumes of Batman, which worn by none other than Ben Affleck himself. And if you keep going further and further down, you'll see the entire Suicide Squad. See those bars right there?
Yep.
Exact props from the movie.
Wow. So now, we haven't seen Suicide Squad yet. Like, who is the main character in Suicide Squad?
Well, there's actually several main characters.
Okay.
So you got Deadshot, you got Colonel Flagg, Harley Quinn, which is everyone's personal favorite, Killer Croc, El Diablo, Enchantress, and of course the Joker.
The lead.
The Joker?
The Joker.
Ah.
Played by Oscar-winning actor Jared Leto.
Oh, really? So what's your favorite costume in this room that you've seen so far?
Well, I actually have to be a little bit biased at this point. I'm a diehard Superman fan, so I love the new Superman costume.
Okay.
Now, do they have other variations of the costumes somewhere here? Like maybe the Christopher Reeve Superman, the Michael Keaton Batman?
Actually, we do have that Superman cape worn by Christopher Reeve in our new exhibit called Stage 48, which you guys can check out if you guys take the tour.
Oh.
That's not part of this?
Well, this is like the halfway point, but for right now, this is just focusing on the DC Universe.
Okay. And I've heard that there's some Harry Potter.
Actually, yes, there are. They're on the second floor, which by the end of this summer, we're supposed to get new props and costumes from the new upcoming movie, Fantastic Beasts.
Wow.
This comes out in November.
Is that open right now?
Not right now at this moment, unfortunately.
Is it open to those who are persistent and assertive?
I would not recommend that at all.
So Christopher says, go ahead. Okay. Now, how long is this exhibit going to be here at Warner Brothers Studios in Burbank, California?
Hopefully till the end of time.
Really?
Now, they just had, you were telling us earlier that this was the Batman 75th Anniversary Museum. Now it's been converted to the Batman vs. Superman / Suicide Squad Museum.
Correct, and we're also hopefully in the talks of getting like all the new TV universe in here too. So you have Pops, Costumes, Flash, Arrow, Supergirl, DC's Legends of Tomorrow, Gotham.
Okay. So they're really looking to expand the superhero museum here into not just Batman, Superman universe, but really expanding it out to like the Flash.
Okay. All right, so I have a question. Now, let's say you take, like, how do you get to go to this room? Do you have to take a Warner Brothers studio tour?
Correct. Which it only costs $62 per person. It's a 2-hour tour, which you can see the whole lot, and you get to visit our wonderful archives and Stage 48.
Wow. And what's on Stage 48 right now?
A lot of stuff. Like, they got the set from France, Central Perk in there, the set of Two and a Half Men.
Wow.
A Hobbit scene. Actually, they do have these green screens where you can ride a Hogwarts on a wand, pretend you're Harry Potter, or pretend you're Batman on the Batpod motorcycle driving through Gotham City.
Oh my goodness. So this sounds like a really fun tour. Like, let's say you're visiting LA.
Exactly. It's a good one to stop and check it out. I strongly recommend it.
Okay.
You said it's $62 per person?
Correct.
For a few dollars more, can I see Sarah in that Harley Quinn outfit?
For probably an extra $100, I can't see why not.
I'm not sure if I'm going to fit in that outfit.
If I want to get in one of those Batman outfits, what time do you guys close? What time are you guys not looking?
Well, actually, we open at 8 a.m. and we close at 4:30.
When does it officially open?
This will officially open on this Tuesday, 24th.
May 24th.
Just in time for the Memorial Day weekend rush.
What is your favorite tour that you guys, what's your favorite part of the tour that you guys offer here at Warner Brothers?
Probably the Stage 48, because everyone here loves Friends and they like to recreate an episode on the couch of one of the favorite characters, which you're able to do.
Wow.
Goodness, wow. How many costumes have you tried on here? Just to be honest.
I plead the fifth on that one. I won't say anything until my lawyer's present.
So these are the actual hero costumes. So I know when you go to like Planet of Hollywood, they'll say as seen in. Now, were these actually in the movie?
Yes, these are actually worn by the actors and actresses that portray them.
Okay. So, now, Richard, what has been your favorite costume as you've been walking around?
Being a big Batman fan, I'm loving the Batman uniforms, because in the movie, it looks so foam.
Right.
But here, you look at it, and judging by the way I knocked it over and it broke, it is definitely fiberglass.
Nice. And I really love the Wonder Woman. Like, just the detail on that costume is beautiful. And I am a big Superman fan as well. So I have to go with the Superman costume, too.
Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. The funny part, since you're a Batman fan, did you get a closer look at Joker's tights?
Yes.
What's on them?
They're Batman tights.
Yeah. It's
what?
You can get at the Warner Brothers gift shop.
Oh, wow. Well, I need to go there. Okay. I need to go check it out.
Now, what is the one thing that everyone's really gravitating toward? What's the hub of this DC Universe Museum exhibit at Warner Brothers Studio in Burbank, California?
Possibly the Batman costumes, because everyone thought like Ben Affleck did an amazing job as Batman, and I agree, he's probably the best Batman yet.
Oh, I don't know. Them's fighting words.
Who would you like to see as Batman next? Matt Damon?
I prefer him as the Robin.
That was Chris O'Donnell.
Yeah. If he's still around.
Very close.
All those school ties, kids all look the same.
Yeah. Well, I would say that arguably the biggest exhibit right now is Gene Simmons.
Yeah.
Since he's here introducing the museum. That was a fun surprise.
Well, a tidbit about Gene Simmons. I heard I've been told that he's a huge Superman fan.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, are there any other celebrities we didn't see?
There might or might not be Mark Hamill right there.
What?
Just kidding.
Oh!
We're outside now. Outside right now.
All right. Well, thank you, Christopher.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Christopher. Getting my hopes up. So thank you, Christopher. And we didn't get your last name, but thank you, Christopher, for giving us such a great interview and letting us know all about the DC Universe, the exhibit. And he also
whole tour. Like, I really want to take
the
Warner
Brothers
tour. He also
told us about the tour that we're going to take sometime in the fall.
Yeah.
And this exhibit is only a tiny part of the whole tour.
Right.
Where you can go see some of the Harry Potter sets.
I know.
And with that, let's head over to Tiki Cantina, where we talk about the upcoming Star Wars Celebration Orlando.
Ooh,
now, tickets had just been released on May the 25th.
The prices are as follows. $150 online in advance for a 4-day ticket. So that's a pretty good deal. I would figure they were going to be about that range.
Yeah, that's pretty average. $170. Yeah. On site.
Right, but they may not be available. They may sell out. Oh, and also we have the VIP Jedi Knights, which we know will sell out within like 10 minutes. Yeah. Those are $700. But did you look at some of the perks? They actually get a signing and a meet and greet with a celebrity that is yet unnamed.
Which means they have no idea.
Yeah, that's
true. Ouch is right. Now, Thursday and Friday, ticket prices are only $65. Saturday, $75. And Sunday, $65.
Okay, so single day tickets, $65, except for Saturday, where they bump it up to $75. That makes sense. Child tickets... A four-day ticket is $70, so it's...
Now, I think those tickets should be more expensive.
Why?
Because it's always the children who are chosen for anything. When someone on a panel says, hey, we need a volunteer, we don't even bother raising our hands.
Aww.
We know it's going to be a child. So if a child has those kind of perks, let's bump them up to like $500 for 4 days.
Okay.
Taking our spots.
Yeah.
Yeah, taking our spots. What's up with that? Rebel spy. I'm a little bitter.
This is because we don't have children. All right. So let's head
over
to the...
If you look over to the website, it does say you can rent children for this purpose.
Perfect.
Asterisk doesn't really say that.
Yay.
All right. Now let's talk Star Wars Celebration Anaheim.
Can I bring my drink?
Star Wars Celebration Orlando.
Oops.
Star Wars Celebration conventions are coming as fast as Star Wars movies themselves. In less than 2 months, Celebration Europe will hit in London. Then, in less than 1 year, Celebration returns to the States in Orlando, Florida. As soon as word hit, the fandom community lit up with excitement.
We posted in our Facebook group asking what you want to see this time around and got an overwhelming response. We also reached out to some Celebration veterans and asked them to come on and share their thoughts. Star Wars author and my Fangirls Going Rogue co-host, Trisha Barr, will also be attending Star Wars Celebration Europe and will be breaking some news right here on Skywalking Through Neverland.
Hey, Trisha.
Hey, I'm really excited. I, you know, and I felt so bad. I wanted it to be Orlando, and they said Orlando, and I felt bad for you guys. So.
Aww. Well, that's okay.
I guess it is your turn.
Yeah. Well, I hope it goes back and forth. But yeah. I'm glad it's going to be in Florida and not in August.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
The saving grace there. All right. Also joining us in this discussion is Rick Peralta from LiningUp.net and his 8-year-old daughter, the secret keeper herself, Eliza Peralta. Hey, Rick and Eliza.
Hey, Skywalkers.
Yay.
Hey, so glad to have everyone here on this edition of Skywalking Through Neverland, because there's just so much to talk about. But first, Eliza and Rick, tell us about your new podcast.
Oh, well, it's at the very early stages here. We've done our first recording, but I'm still working on trying to edit it all together. The idea actually kind of sprung from, well, as you guys know, we're very active. We not only are we active with the stuff that you guys know and love, Star Wars and Disneyland and whatnot, but we're also really busy with just kind of exposing Eliza to the world. And I thought it'd be fun to have people kind of express interest in knowing what she's up to. Well, I thought it'd be fun to have a show where we chatted about the things that we do. And it's, you know, her ice hockey that she's learning. It's the rock climbing. It's, you know, the travels that we do. You know, we're doing a big road trip this summer up to Northern Idaho. So we'll just kind of talk about the stuff that we do.
Oh,
awesome.
Nice. And you know what? Speaking of Northern Idaho, Eliza, who's the voice of Chopper?
Natalie!
She is good. See, she is very, very
good.
Yes,
she is.
All right. Now let's talk Celebration.
Yeah, definitely.
Let's start by looking back. How many celebrations have we all attended, and what has been your favorite so far? Trisha, what do you think?
Oh, probably the last one.
Celebration Anaheim.
Anaheim, yeah. What does that count? It's seven. That's seven, right?
Well, would it be?
It all depends if you're counting the Europe and Japan.
Yeah.
Or
zero. Or
the
what?
Celebration Zero. That's right. Thank you, Rick.
Yeah, that was, I don't think you can top the the Force Awakens, seeing the trailer for the first time and all that, just being there with fans and knowing that a movie was coming. Although the next closest vibe would be three, seeing the footage from Revenge of the Sith.
Oh.
And I remember Rick McCallum's like, do you want me to talk about it or you want to show it again? We're like, show it again. So
yeah, I guess JJ and KK learned their lesson and just re-showed it because we had no idea what Han said.
Chewie, we're home.
If they hadn't shown it again, I probably would have, it kind of went by and I was like, what just happened? Like, there was a Star Destroyer. I missed the X-Wing. I remember that in the sand. So there were things that if I hadn't seen again, oh, I would have missed it.
Yeah.
Now, how many conventions have you been to?
I started at 3, 4, 5, 6, and then Anaheim, and then I've been to Europe. So I'm starting on a second hand here.
Whoa.
Nice.
Wow, veteran.
Now, Rick, how about you? How many conventions, celebration conventions, have you been to? And starting with which one?
I'm sorry to say that I have very, very little experience with the celebrations. I just did a single day when it was in Los Angeles.
So for
Celebration 4.
Yeah, exactly. And actually, the reason that I went to that one in the first place was fellow LiningUp.net members, Jeff and Sayla, were attending that. And Jeff actually proposed to her on the X-Wing set up. So we were there for that. After that, it was Anaheim. And that's all I've done.
Oh, wow. Well, and what about Eliza?
No, you haven't done Zero. You were there last year.
Eliza, you were at Celebration Zero? I thought I recognized you.
She's a time traveler.
Yeah, it's odd that you're only 8 years old, and that was, what, that was almost 30 years ago? Oh, my goodness. My goodness.
Wow.
So Eliza, she only has been to the Celebration Anaheim.
Yeah, and, you know, of course, you know, I've always wanted to take her to something like that. And with the new one, the new movies coming out, it was obviously we got that much more excited about this stuff. But, you know, her excitement for Rebels so perfectly coincide with Celebration Anaheim happening that it was kind of a natural that we were going to do it. And now, like, I'm taking her out of school and I don't care. She's going to, this is important. And so we did all the days, and that's we're planning on doing it again here in Orlando.
Well, you're a awesome. Good dad. Eliza, what's your favorite memory from Celebration Anaheim?
You don't whisper in my ear. You got to tell him.
We want to hear what you have to say.
But the mics aren't that sensitive.
My favorite one was when I got to be on stage because it was my first time being on stage. And it was really neat to ask questions to the rebel people to ask them.
So let me get this straight. I've been to 5 celebration conventions. Eliza's been to 1, and she's already on stage.
She's even got the being the rebel spy beat.
Okay, stop! Stop! And she's 8.
Not only was she on stage, but she was on the Blu-ray. So.
And Eliza's going to direct the next Star Wars standalone film, isn't she?
You ready for that?
Yeah, you know, let's get off this subject. This is just making me upset.
Faster, more intense, and you got it.
And just wear your best flannel, okay? Do you have any flannel, Eliza? All right, you know what, let's jump forward then and talk about Celebration Orlando. And needless to say, we're all excited about it, but less than thrilled that it's happening over Easter weekend. Now, when you first heard this announcement, what did you think, Trisha?
I didn't even think Easter. How's that? So. And it wouldn't have mattered to me. You know, that's a double-edged sword because some people, it's like, great, it's near, for Florida, where I live, that's kind of when their spring break is. Mm. So it makes it easy for locals probably to get there. And then for other people, that might not be convenient because they have a lot of family obligations or church obligations. But I'm sure that they can have service Sunday in Orlando.
Right, and it's also Passover for those of the Jewish persuasion, and it's also tax season. as well. My gosh.
Yeah, that's more of a Christian holiday.
I didn't even think about tax season. Now that you have to get done early.
Yeah.
You just have to hope you've got a really good refund before you hit the celebration store.
Well, it sounds like Trisha's got her priorities set then. Now, yeah. Rick, did this even have an impact on you knowing that it was Easter weekend?
Well, I mean, honestly, when I first heard about it, I was like, well, it's Orlando. There's no way this can happen. And, you know, of course, you've got that great new little Facebook group. And I mentioned, you know, people were asking about it. And I'm like, I don't see how it can happen. And immediately people were even talking about creating GoFundMes so that they could meet Eliza. So I'm like, okay, well, I think we're going to try to find a way to make this happen. And of course, yours and our and good friend, Missy Kaya, mm-hmm. You know, was offering all kinds of little tips and tricks to try to find a way to make it happen. And next thing I knew it went, okay, well, we're going to try to figure it out. Lisa, my wife is a teacher, and thankfully her spring break coincides with that week. So it's perfect for her. But my daughter, Eliza, does not have that week off. Ugh. So she's going to have like the week before off for school, and then we're going to take her out for a week.
Oh, you are an amazing dad.
But yeah, you know, the Easter component was a little bit of a concern. I'm actually, you know, we live with our mother-in-law's with my mother-in-law as well. And she's decided she wanted to go along with us too. And because she's, you know, to do Disney World, it would be Eliza my first time to go to Florida, period, let alone Disney World or to see, you know, the Wizarding World or anything like that. And so it's like, we got to do this all as a family. And then we kind of started realizing a couple days into it that, wait a minute, this is Easter. So that means big crowds, but it also means, well, we do big family get-togethers for Easter. And I guess they're just going to miss us this year.
Yeah.
Well, Eliza, just to let you know that Easter bunnies in Florida are called hoojibs.
We have hoojib hunts.
Yeah, just so you're not confused.
And I do think that Matt Clifton nailed it on the head, and we really have to have a hoojib hunt while we're there.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
we're going to plan something.
All right. Well, speaking of what we want to really see at Star Wars Celebration Orlando, what are at the top of all of our lists? Trisha?
Another movie reveal with Rian Johnson. That's really simple. I just enjoy – I had so much fun going to the Star Wars Dark Side half marathon because I wanted to see my friends. So for me, Celebration's about seeing all my Star Wars friends and then sharing the experience. So I really don't care what happens. Although I have asked again to see they did the stunt at Celebration. Let's see, 3. Nick Galar talked about the lightsaber stunts. And that was one of my favorite panels. So I'm hoping to see something like that again. So we haven't seen anything like that in advance of The Force Awakens. But I'd like to see some type of panel on the choreography for the stunts.
Mm. All right, so then you want to see Pip Anderson show up.
I think Pip was in like 2 seconds of the movie. Oh.
Just hit him a riot baton and say, okay, show us what you did and teach us. Those are some awesome moves.
Exactly.
Rick, what do you want to see at Star Wars Celebration Orlando?
Well, you know, honestly, when we did the last one, I was such a neophyte to the whole concept of podcast that I didn't even enter the podcast room or see any of that stuff. I didn't even know who you guys were when we met there.
How dare you?
And so, honestly, that's a big part of what I'm looking forward to is to meet all the fellow Skywalkers that I've now come to know. And I'm looking forward to seeing some of the things that I didn't even really stop to think about seeing last time around, like the podcast stage, like a couple of the panels that like the radio drama. You know, I didn't even really think about trying to get into those things. And it'd be kind of cool to see some of that.
Yeah,
there's just always so much going on. So
there's too many things to choose from, and so I went to the things that I thought I knew what I was going to be getting and what I wanted, and then I ended up missing out some really cool things that I didn't even realize what I was missing.
Well, mm-hmm. Speaking as a veteran, you're always going to miss something.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, definitely.
But the good thing about that is it's like happens every year or 2 years, and so the more you move on, you go on, your priorities change.
Oh, big time.
Yeah.
Eliza, what do you want to see at the next Star Wars convention? And don't say more stage time.
What I really want to see at this Star Wars convention is I really want to see new Star Wars stuff. I want to see new Star Wars things that I never seen before. And more little tiny Star Wars toys.
Toys, of course.
Oh, the merchandise.
You want to hit the dealer room, don't you?
I don't know.
Eliza, did you like the cosplaying at Celebration Anaheim?
Yeah.
Yeah. What was your favorite costume?
My favorite costume.
The favorite one that you, somebody that you saw or you met while you're wandering around. Well, there was the Merida Jedi. You really liked her an awful lot.
She was cool.
And then there was the Hera.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there's the family.
Yeah, that's right. The Perales family.
Yeah. Eliza, did Dave Filoni let you wear his hat?
No.
All right, I'm just wondering. All right, Sarah, what are you looking forward to most at Celebration Orlando?
Well, like I was saying, it's interesting how your priorities change after being at several different conventions.
Uh-huh.
So like, I know our focus for Celebration 5 and 6 was like seeing the big, big panels with like Mark Hamill and Carrie Fisher and everything. And we managed to get into those. And now with all of our press things that we do, you know, we see a lot of celebrities. And so now it my focus is more about seeing the people that I see every day on social media, you know, Skywalkers, and, you know, meeting with all of you. I think the podcast meetups were some of my very favorite things.
So it almost sounds like
Anaheim.
You're favoring the Star Wars fan days.
Yeah. Oh, I guess.
Rather than the celebrations.
Well, oh, really? Is that what fan days are all about?
I've never been to one, but as far as I've heard on other podcasts, mm-hmm. it focuses on fans, meeting fans,
okay.
and some of the celebrities, but it's really all about the fans.
I mean, I don't know about that, because part of Celebration is us all getting together and talking about all these big events that happen, like the KK and JJ panel and stuff like that. So that's what I'm looking forward to. I also would like a bigger podcast stage and a BB-8 Builders Club. Let's do it.
Yeah. Well, I can definitely echo that. I mean, my favorite thing about the Celebration Anaheim was something I wasn't even really expecting. That was all the fun meetups with all of our new friends and friends on social media and old friends, and getting to really talk with them and going out with them and having the round tables with them and just really focusing on them. And really, we just passed right over the Carrie Fisher.
I know. Well, because it was all being live streamed as well. So Verizon live streaming things.
Yeah. Well, I didn't even really, I knew they were live streaming, but I didn't know you could see it like a week later.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and I think honestly, too, part of it for us was like we skipped the Carrie Fisher thing because, like, you look at the line and how much time you have to devote to waiting, and there were so few things that I really wanted to spend that much time in line for it and miss seeing the floor and just seeing the people wandering around.
I think that's a good thing to note for any future newbies, that you are going to wait a long time in those lines and you're going to miss out on so much. And I think it's always good to see a headliner like Carrie Fisher, because you never know what she's going to say, or someone like Mark Hamill or any of the other stars. But like Sarah, like what you were saying, it's you're always going to adjust your priorities.
Yeah, depending on who you've seen already. I mean, exactly.
Well, I'm also looking forward to a show opener like they did at Celebration Anaheim, where they showed the trailer.
Right.
Something like that, that just unites all the fans and gives them something to talk about.
That's amazing.
Throughout the whole convention.
Sounds like they're going to do that at Star Wars Celebration Europe as well, right, Tricia?
That's what it looks like. It looks like Gareth Edwards and Kathleen Kennedy are going to be speaking first thing off the bat on Friday. Mm-hmm. It's only a 3-day convention over in Europe. But I think that's the right tone. It brought everyone together, kind of created that family atmosphere, except for the guy holding his lightsaber up during the trailer. So don't hold your lightsaber up. Don't be that person.
Oh, my gosh.
Was he in your way?
Yes, and I screamed very loudly, "Put the lightsaber down!" And it went down. So
good for you.
Paul Blart Mall Cop there.
Exactly. I was like, dude, I'm not getting Kylo Ren lightsaber in my first trailer. So,
right.
But yeah, no, it sounds like they're going to open it that way, and I'm excited that they want to go back to kind of that vibe.
Well, I know I'm a year late, but I'm sorry for holding that in front of your face.
I know it wasn't you.
Yeah, I think they really learned. They really learned from Celebration Anaheim, and that one, that minute and a half trailer just brought everyone together.
Oh my God!
Oh, well, and we are in that new realm now here, where we got a new movie every year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that it fits to have an event like that to launch everyone every year.
Right, right. Now I am looking forward to any panels on perhaps Star Wars Land.
Oh my goodness!
Oh,
that will be a huge draw.
You hit the nail on the head there.
Oh my goodness!
I want to see panels. I want to see footage of them building Star Wars Land here and there.
Some of the Imagineering concepts.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be fantastic.
And maybe a date.
Where is, what is the relation to D23 as opposed to Celebration, just for as far as what, where they might put that kind of information? Because isn't D23 what, in July?
Okay.
Yeah, it will be.
Will
it
be July?
2017.
Okay.
It's like a week before Comic-Con.
That's right.
Yeah.
Take that, Comic-Con.
April, May, June, July. So three months.
Yeah, so we might get a little bit there, and I think that would be a popular panel to be very interesting.
Definitely.
Yeah, and I know there's going to be a lot on episode 8 because we're right around the corner for episode 8 at that time. But I really want to see something, and I'm not sure how practical this would be. But since they'll be doing the effects at that point, I want to see them shooting some of those actual live effects right there on a special effects stage, just so when we see episode 8 we can go, hey, I was there when they shot that.
Wow.
And that's,
you know, you're saying something that actually I would love to see. Like, I know that you, with the Tron stuff, like they actually got the crowd chanting at Comic-Con, just repeating a chant over and over again, and that was the sound they used in the movie for the Disc Wars. And so to do something like that would be amazing, to have a room full of giant Star Wars fans at Celebration just chanting and being a background noise for something.
That would be even better.
Wow, that would be cool.
That would be very cool, just to make us part of the films itself.
Absolutely.
Wow, you know what? Let's send a memo to, hey, Trisha, while you're in Europe, can you go and send a memo to KK?
Sure, I'll look her up.
I don't think she's going to do that.
You know, the funny thing is that I'm not dropping much here, but I was actually at a meeting with my lineingup.net cohorts yesterday, starting kind of our beginning discussions of Rogue One and on how we're going to move ourselves forward. And of course, Obi-Shan was there with his car, and we were just meeting in a park in East LA. But afterwards, we're putting things away, and everyone's walking by and wanting to get pictures with his car. And of course, I'm there in my kilt, as always, but I'm also with my full beard looking very George Lucas right now. And some people walk by and like, and that's George Lucas, too. And so, you know, I'll throw in what I can for you.
Oh, definitely nice. Play into that. Now, speaking of George Lucas, I would love to see Lucas do a, he won't do a panel, but at least be there. And
you know, what would be really cool is if they had him just there to talk about his new museum. If he just had a little, whether it was a panel, and it wasn't specifically Star Wars related, but it was about his new museum project, I bet he'd be willing to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or at that point, he might be just say, you know what? Never mind the museum. Never mind. I tried so many years, so many times. It's not going to happen. I'm going to open up a Burger King instead, okay? Would that make you guys happy?
Memorabilia on the walls.
Yeah, but I would love to see some kind of George Lucas presence there.
Yeah.
Well, then I'll wear my plaid shirt one day, okay?
Oh, there you go. There you go.
That might be the closest as we get.
Well, now looking ahead, is there something special that any of you are planning that will make Celebration Orlando unique? Let's see, Trisha, let's start with you.
Oh, well, only time will tell.
Okay. Well, I think you're already looking forward to Europe, right?
Well, yes, for Europe, for me. So, I have that lucky advantage of getting to do that one first. So I'm just going to ride the high. So it's a less than 11 months between that. It's kind of crazy, right?
It is.
That they'll be so close. But, you know, again, just meeting the fans. I hope they do the podcast stage again. And I hope to recreate something to approximate the Saturday that we had in Anaheim, which for me started with, I don't know, we had Rebels, we had the podcast stage, you had the interview on the red carpet, and then ended with the book signing. So
yeah,
play that, something, that was something on them.
Day. Not much could top Rebels Day. That was amazing.
Oh, very much so.
Yeah.
Of course, I'm a little biased.
Yeah.
Now, Rick, is liningup.net, are they planning to do anything for Celebration Orlando?
Well, I know that there's at least a handful of us that are talking about going, and we really haven't started discussing anything that far down the road yet as a group, but I know for sure that you know, I'm planning on going with at least a handful of my liningup.net shirts and probably a handful of flyers that I can hand out as I go around to just kind of spread the word, because as you guys know, after doing it with us, it's not just Angelinos that are lining up. We come from everywhere. And I know that at least one person that I'm a good friend of mine that I've actually never met in person, we're planning on doing it together. She lives up in Connecticut, and she's coming down with her daughter. And they fully intend to join one of our lines after watching what we've gone through and everything she saw online with the social media stuff with us. So,
will you plan it? A special meetup for everyone as a, hey, everyone, this is an introductory meeting for those of you who don't know us.
Yeah, I would not be surprised at all if we end up putting something like together. Again, that's so far down the road to have something specific set up. I don't know yet, but I would love to do something like that. Absolutely.
Well, I know it's only 11 months away, but my head is reeling from the stuff that
we've already been planning. Go ahead, Richard. Yeah.
Well, of course, the podcast stage show, and even if there's not a stage show opportunity, if they want to pick different podcasts that didn't get to do it last time, or they just said no for some reason,
right,
we're still going to do one.
Somehow?
Yeah, we're going to...
I think we should do one in downtown Disney.
Oh.
Disney Springs.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I guess we'll have to go through the media first, won't we?
Yeah, right. Yeah, red tape. That's what we're all about.
You'll have to, if you have a mic, just run up your sleeve, and maybe that'll work if it's just hidden.
There you go.
I think we should do it flash mob style.
5-minute meetup over here. Okay, now, that's the Skywalking meetup. Okay, fangirls going around, 5-minute over here.
It's like a geocache thing or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, when security shows up, everyone just runs like rats on a ship.
Yeah.
We all know where location 4 and 5 and A and B and L will be.
Yeah.
You'll never find us. So at some point, we're going to do a podcast stage show, no matter who.
Even if you set up your own little soapbox to do it.
Yep.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. And of course, I know we're already planning on doing the roundtable meetup like we did before.
At the end,
right?
Sunday?
Just to recap.
Yes.
And meetups at Disneyland, Disney World.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have like a meetup every 15 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. I know people in the group, some of you guys will be there before Celebration starts. And I know there's already talk of meeting up beforehand. And some of us will be there after Celebration ends at, you know, the Disney parks. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you guys staying for the run?
No. We can't take up 2 weekends in a row.
Yeah. Ugh.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, I was almost wishing they would roll it into the same weekend.
Oh, they
that would be a lot. That would be a
you
lot.
You are a glutton for punishment.
Yeah. How would you ever be able to do that?
I know. It would be to the point where you wouldn't get any sleep. But you know how that time, like when you were in college cramming for a test,
yeah,
you got to the point where you didn't sleep for like 2 days, and at that point, it didn't even matter
You'd
anymore.
You'd have to become a vampire.
Yeah, you were comatose. But still, you got through it, and it was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
So
of course, we've got a couple decades on our college years now, so I don't know about that.
Well, maybe for you, Rick, it was Red Bull. For me, it was Dunkin' Donuts and Nodos.
Yeah, I honestly, we're the same generation pretty much. So yeah, Nodos was closer for me.
And of course, Sunday being Easter, we're planning a celebrate the Hujib holiday. No concrete plans just as of yet.
Right.
We just know we're going to do something surrounding Hujibs and Easter.
What is this cool you have written here? Hujib pancake hut? I mean,
well,
I can't say
I
that.
I didn't want to say Hujib hunt, because that
right
sounds like you're hunting for Hujibs.
Right. No, what did we settle on? We settled on the... we didn't write it down. I don't remember, but we had something fun that kind of like lilted along. And I don't remember.
Well, it was something more to the effect of what Disneyland did for Easter, where they have they give you a map,
right,
and you go and find the Easter eggs hidden,
right,
everywhere.
Right.
So it'll be something reminiscent of that as of now, but that may change and turn into something really big,
right,
which I'm sure it will. And Amanda Bond can be there as our spokesperson in her Hoojib costume.
Yes.
So
that'll be fun.
It'll be something surrounding Hoojibs, I can guarantee you that.
Yep.
A Hoojib basket to wander around on Sunday.
Exactly.
Exactly. Eliza, do you have your Hoojib basket ready to go?
No.
Mom gonna have to sew that together for you?
Yeah. Eliza, do you know what a Hoojib is, right?
I'm showing her pictures on my phone right now.
Oh, good.
What are they teaching these kids in school these days? Where's our tax dollars at work, Eliza?
You know, sorry, your Star Wars Marvel's comics show is audio only, so it loses something for her. I'm explaining that.
Oh, I see. I got you.
Yeah,
I
plus,
gotcha.
We're like 50 episodes away from that issue.
Well, let's go into what some of our Skywalkers said about what they are expecting for Star Wars Celebration Orlando. So Chickafent wrote in an email, since they're so eloquent. Since the podcast, and this is what they said, since the podcast stage seemed to be a big success at Celebration Anaheim, I hope that gets expanded in Orlando. They should provide a larger room to accommodate more fans, since I'm pretty sure podcasting fandom has grown since Anaheim. Allowing more podcasts to participate would also be a nice change. This would be a great way to recognize and celebrate how the podcast community continues to keep Star Wars discussions going all year long.
Yeah, that room was tiny.
Yeah, it was.
It was like 100-seat room.
Which was annoying about that, because we went to WonderCon to scout that room, and it was three times as big.
Yeah.
Because they hadn't, you know, knocked off
the party in the wall.
Yeah. And we were like, yes, this is going to be awesome. This will fit like 300 people. And
plus they had a big jumbotron. I thought, oh, we get access to a jumbotron?
Yeah.
And I was so excited. So I was planning up all these things and all these...
Yeah.
Videos
to
show.
You had a PowerPoint presentation, didn't you?
I did. I had graphs. I had charts. I had an abacus, which doesn't.
Oh, you were ready.
Yeah, I was ready. And then I find out we're in a tiny broom closet.
Yeah. Richard thinks big.
That's so funny.
Like trying to do a Run Disney.
yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah. See, there you go. All right.
Gotta make the most of it. You only live once. Or if you're a Jedi, forever.
Now, is there some more Facebook comments here I can read?
Oh, there's a ton. We put out the Facebook notice this morning, and within like, what, 10 minutes?
10 minutes, we had like 10 comments. It was fun. All right, so people obviously are passionate about Celebration. And so we compiled all these comments, and really the number one request. Now, these are things that people want to change for Celebration Orlando. The number one request was put an item limit on purchases at the Star Wars Celebration store.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So Jeremy Hunt, David Manderville, Michelle, Matt Clifton, and John Fowler all mentioned this. Now, I thought David Manderville had an interesting idea. He suggested this. The line in the Celebration store was stupid long. Waited 4 hours, not even kidding, to shop. Maybe have the store in a separate location instead of in the middle of the con floor. OCCC, Orlando Convention Center, has two huge buildings. Put the store in the other one from the actual con.
At three, which was the first one I went to, the line was so long that it was creating a fire hazard. So I don't know how they ended up back in, they still get back in the same problem again. You know, I just didn't even go buy stuff, which was the worst part of it. They lost my money on a lot of things. So I didn't get to comment on that, but you can add mine to that list.
Okay.
I know we wanted to buy some things, and they were out of a lot of different items because...
Yeah, because we went in on Sunday. It was the only day we could get in.
Because a lot... But we would see these same items on the vendors' tables out in the dealer room.
Yeah.
There should definitely be a way to get these items online, which would really decrease the time you're waiting in line.
Right, right. Yeah.
I mean, to be able to, like, almost like you could RSVP or pre-order and only be able to pick up there.
Right. Yeah, exactly. They should have a pre-order thing like they do for Run Disney events. Well, here, John Fowler made a really interesting comment. He says, as much as I hate the merchandise events at Star Wars weekends, I think something like that would greatly benefit Celebration. If not, please put limits on all the purchases. So what that means, basically, you know how at Star Wars weekends they had that pre-buy day where if you bought a ticket to get in to buy the exclusive merchandise first?
Yeah, they had, it was only like the last two years that they did it. And they should really, just one thing, they should enforce that the vendors in there aren't buying stuff and putting it back on their tables. That's easy enough to enforce that. You can't stop people from doing it on eBay, but the people who are vending there should have an agreement to not. That's just silly.
Yeah.
But I understand the mentality of it and how that happens. And, you know, there's a premium on getting that some of those items, but it's almost like they don't every year they end up with the same problem. But I'm hoping maybe they can utilize, now they have Disney employees, that maybe they can use some of their staff and get them in the people. It's not the bot. It's not the going in and getting stuff. It was the checking out that was creating a lot of the backlog. So if they get the people, and they fix that at Star Wars weekends over time, they realize they just needed more people for people to buy stuff, and then they could get people through the lines. So maybe they can utilize staff a little bit in the Celebration store since they are working together now.
Maybe it was because at Celebration 4, they had such a huge overstock of items that their main concern is just to get this stuff out the door. And if someone wants to buy 100 Darth Vader snow globes, so be it.
Are you knocking snow globes?
Not at all. But if someone wants to buy 100 of them, they're not going to hold back. They're going to say, okay, just go ahead and take them because we want to make sure that these shelves are clear by the end of the convention. So moving on from what we don't like about the lines, because we could do a whole podcast series on that.
Yeah. Let's see what people are looking forward to. And the number one thing was meeting up with friends and Skywalkers old and new. So nearly everyone's comment included this. So we thought that was sweet. Like you guys as well.
Martin Keeler says, live podcasts, sure, check. Meeting up with friends, check. Mark Daniel and Elliot Hansen, check, check. We're going to hear from Mark Daniel in just a little bit about his thoughts on Celebration Europe in Orlando.
Yep.
And he's looking forward to hashtag Cantina.
Yes, at Celebration Europe.
Celebration Europe.
And it just so happens that he is the organizer of this event.
Trisha, what do you know about hashtag Cantina? Is it just called Cantina or
wait,
hashtag?
Wait, is it Number Cantina?
It's Number Cantina. And will forever be what's your number sign. I will not be embarrassed about that, showing my age.
You're embracing it.
Number Cantina.
I'm embracing it. I'll say, what's this celebration's hashtag?
There you go.
Although, I am impressed that they gave the celebrations a hashtag already because... Yeah. That Twitter, the Star Wars fans used to kind of be like, ugh, because they'd give it too long of a hashtag. It's SWCO for Orlando. Mm-hmm. So, yay.
I know.
Early hashtags. Now we can just go find it.
Exactly. Exactly.
So, Trisha, are you going to this hashtag Cantina?
I'm not, because it's a big mystery to me. It's such a mystery that I've only heard about it recently and within the last couple of weeks, and I asked around and it was still a kind of a mystery. So how's that for
well, tickets,
it might be too big of a mystery for some people over here in America, and I feel like I'm not a person who's out of the know, so
that's true. Well, if you listen later on in this podcast, you'll hear a little more about it from Mark Daniel.
Now, I like this idea from Chickafin, and he's Chickafin. It's an elephant and a chicken. But Chickafin is suggesting really more fan organized panels.
Oh.
And I think that's a tremendous idea.
Mm-hmm.
They have like the R2 Builders Club, the 501st does their thing, and just really all the fans who have something to say or something to present. And they've done this in the past at Celebration Anaheim. They Mary Franklin put out something saying, hey, if you guys have an idea for a panel, right, let me know.
Well, even Trisha, you headed up a panel.
I did. I had headed up a panel, a diversity of opinions from a certain point of view. And they did, Celebration Europe is having fan panels again. And from all my understanding is that that's more Disney mindset now that Disney's in charge, that the celebration used to be really collector oriented. And they also, you know, there were certain cosplay groups that got stage, had a lot of presence, and others didn't. So there's a lot going to be a lot more of spreading it around to a more diversity of opinions of fans, not just collecting. And I've seen that kind of in how the panels went out and how they pushed some topics late in the Anaheim. Some of the panels that showed up were kind of in response to that. But I know there will be a lot of fan panels at Celebration Europe, and it's really hard to tell right now. I am doing a panel. I can't even talk about it yet. How's that for? and it's not because it's top secret. It's just that the process seems to be a little bit slower with the second layer of Disney on top of everything. Oh. So, you know, they're trying to enforce what they want. And but I appreciate that they're getting out there and looking at panel at what fans want to talk about, because sometimes what they want to talk about isn't necessarily what we want to hear. So maybe letting the fans run those panels. And I'm excited because Amy Ratcliffe is from Full of Sith and Lattes with Leia is hosting the behind the scenes stage and in Celebration Europe. So that's again, podcasters coming in, because Jimmy and Jason from Rebel Force Radio hosted last time. And so she's a fan, but she, you know, she works on stuff and has some inside perspective, but really she's there to represent what the fan wants to know behind the scenes. And even looking at it 10 years ago, Amy would have been one of those people that would have had a hard time coming into fandom because, you know, she came in late. She came in for the Clone Wars and Rebels, not as a movie fan. So, you know, that was a kind of a hard barrier to break through. And now she's hosting a whole stage, which is so cool. So I think they're going to go that way.
Nice.
So will she be co-hosting this with Eliza?
Yes.
Okay. I just figured Eliza's going to be up there somewhere. Just looking down and pointing at me and laughing.
Oh, okay.
But has there been, aside from the poor line management and hoarding of merchandise, is there something else from the past celebrations that disappointed anyone?
Well, I mean, again, my experience really just with Los Angeles was it just felt like that was just severely underplanned to me. And Anaheim, while it was well planned, it was poor crowd control. Maybe they just need to hire lineingup.net. We know how to do
it. Nice.
Yeah, but then again, that worked to our benefit since no one really knew what was going on with the lines. We said, okay, we're going to make our own line and just walked right in.
And then we saw Trisha, and we followed her.
Nice.
So when in doubt, just follow Trisha.
Okay, let me go.
Yeah. Yeah. Trisha, how about you? Has there been something that you thought, this could do without this?
You know, the only time I ever decided anything I didn't enjoy was the sleet in Indianapolis. So, but everything else is just kind of part of the, I don't know, it's part of the crazy experience. So I don't envy their job of having to plan these things. Just the store, make it easier for us. And other than that, my recommendation is don't put a major book author signing next to Mark Hamill signing at the same time, because I saw that happen and the crowd was just, it got to where it was like a bottleneck. And then I was like, I think if there was a fire right now, I would die because there's no room for anybody to move. So, you know, those things aside.
Okay.
That's almost what happened with John Ratzenberger at Star Wars Celebration Anaheim. He was right next to Billy Dee Williams, so you couldn't tell whose line was who.
Uh-oh.
So no one was really in his line, and I think he was really aggravated So when we got a chance to talk to him, he wasn't the nicest of
fellows.
Of actors. Yeah. So I think just because he was shoved way back there, it's right. This is John Ratzenberger. Put him somewhere out in the, move Chief Jawa number 4, put him back here, and put Major Durlin right over here.
Well, do you guys, I was curious, now that there's the selfie age, do you think it'll change that it won't be as much about autographs, but more about getting a chance just to get a selfie? Someone even asked Mark Hamill about that, and he said he thought selfies were more valuable to take with a star because you could.
Well, also what I like about that is it's something that, it's not about something that's going to turn around and get sold.
Yeah. Right.
It'll be a personal thing.
That's a really good point. I think, and plus they're faster to take sometimes.
Maybe they could just line everybody up and you get in there and there's a professional Disney photographer.
Yeah, the Disney photo pass people.
Just whipping you through. We could get 500 more people through to selfies.
Maybe our tickets for Celebration will just be magic bands and we'll use that.
I think the autographs will never go out of style because everyone... look, there's a big contingent of fans that just love autographs.
I'm so not an autograph person.
Did you guys watch the Billboard Awards last night?
No.
Everybody in the stand, everybody had their phones up and they were just taking pictures of themselves with the stage behind them. That's what happened the whole time. It's just a different,
it has a
generation's change. It's just different. So, maybe when we're all old with canes, they won't care.
Yeah, well, it's not about even taking in the experience anymore. It's everyone putting up their phones to capture it for later. And then you can't
even
see.
They don't experience it right then, yeah.
Yeah, especially for, short people like me. It's so aggravating.
I'm just going to bring a super soaker.
Yeah. Well, that's why I really
put it into all your iPhones.
That's why I really liked that Verizon was live streaming things because no one felt the need to capture it with their phones because they knew it was being captured professionally.
Yeah.
So that was my number one yay.
I just wish that maybe they did say this, and I missed it, that this was going to be streaming all week long on StarWars.com.
Well, it's still there. You can go find the streams. Yeah.
Because they would put up one, then they would take it down. I don't have good six-hour chunk to sit down and watch.
It was no longer on the front page, but you can still find it.
Well, I looked and I couldn't find it.
Yeah.
But I'm very glad that I think that's one of the biggest pioneering aspects of these conventions is that they're live streaming. I think that is a plus and a minus for those fans who are I'll just watch it at home on my computer.
But then they're involved.
Hopefully that'll also thin the crowds a little bit.
Yeah, definitely. That's true. And that's the plus.
Thanks to that live streaming, it's like when Eliza got up on stage, that was so random. We didn't expect that at all. We were just picked out a line. And then we had nobody in the crowd to take pictures for us. And so I was I was scouring the internet trying to find anyone that had gotten a picture, asking friends, and nobody gotten anything. And a week later, there was the live stream posted as a YouTube video, and I was able to find it and get some screen captures and look, there she is. And that I wouldn't have had that otherwise.
Yeah
Rick, I get it.
Until the Blu-ray.
She was on stage and we weren't, okay? I get it.
But you had your own stage.
That's very true. Hey, were you guys at the last tour to Endor at Celebration? Was that, I keep getting 5 and 6 confused.
6.
5.
5.
Really?
5.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Oh, that was one of the highlights, but it was that morning that people were lining up to see George Lucas. So you were up from 2 a.m. until 1 a.m.
Yes.
Well,
but
that wasn't
exciting.
The best planning, but that was so much fun where we celebrated the closing of the initial Star Tours, so they could revamp it for the adventure continues.
Nice.
Well, one of the best things ever was the Indiana Jones Star Wars crossover stunt show, which there's only been 3 shows. And as a matter of fact, I know that if you went to, I think it was the second one, you would see George Lucas.
We were there at the first one.
Yeah.
What about you?
I was in the first one, and then I was in one of the lines later on, so guys are like, dude, I saw George Lucas! And I'm like,
Yeah, ours had Warwick Davis, and I think Jeremy Bullock, and Matt Lanter.
Yeah.
Just not us, and I think Eliza was in there, too.
Yeah. Always there. Always.
Well, speaking of that, would like so next Star Wars Celebration Orlando, what do we want to see for a Disney Parks crossover?
Oh, I hope they have an event, a night, a night, and do the fireworks and special collectible items and just Star Wars fans at the park.
That would be awesome.
A complete neophyte. I have no idea what I'd want.
Oh.
For me, I would want to see an unveiling of a certain piece of Star Wars land. That would be just
entrance gate. Just the entrance gate.
Yeah, there you go. Something.
Give me a kiosk. I don't care. Just unveil something while we're all right there. You have a captive audience. We're all right there. Show us. I don't care. A pod racing pod. A pod racer pod. I don't care.
Well, you know what? I would want it to be called First Tour to Jakku. Or something like that. First tour to somewhere, wherever Star Wars Land ends up being.
Yeah, last tour. Well,
to Endor, honestly, I keep suspecting that we're not going to that Star Wars Land name is going to change.
Yeah,
that's what I would love to see is that entry gate reveal.
Oh, there
knowing
you go.
The name right up above and finally knowing what it's really called.
Ooh, that would be exciting.
They pull down the curtain and it says Star Wars Land.
That's okay. It's an easy hashtag.
Brought to you by the Energizer Bunny. Hoojib.
Brought to you by the
Energizer Hoojibs.
Well, okay. So, Trisha, Star Wars Celebration Europe is coming up. Now, did you have some special news you'd like to announce?
Yes, I do. Speaking of people talking about wanting to see podcasters, there will be a podcasting stage from Star Wars Celebration Europe. And yay! And Fangirls Going Rogue will be represented. We will be teaming up with Star Wars Report. So Riley and Bethany Blanton, and coming from Star Wars Celebration Europe on Saturday, we will be there live on the stage. And this is all put together by Mark Newbold's been running this show. So, and it's called the 1/4 stage. So it's the UK Garrison, Rebel Legion, the Galactic Academy, Jedi News, and there's not a lot of American podcasts, but a lot of international podcasts. So yes, we will be representing in Europe.
Awesome. I'm so excited, Fangirl Flail.
Yeah.
Yay!
Well, that's very good news. Well, not only because Fangirls Going Rogue will be international, but that means they're definitely going to do it in Orlando.
Yeah.
I think so, yeah. I mean, that's kind of... Well, and I don't know if you guys saw this, but Kathleen Kennedy did an interview. Again, she's been doing some more interviews. She mentioned podcasts. When she was introduced to George Lucas, she mentioned bloggers. And she said, oh, George Lucas, you can retire and become a blogger. But she mentioned in her recent interview the importance of podcasts. So you never know when Kathleen Kennedy may be listening. So be in your best behavior.
Hi, Kathleen. Can I be in Star Wars before Eliza?
And she does. Everybody says just JJKK, the JJKK panel. So it'll be the...
Eliza could be LL then?
Yeah.
There you go.
All right. Every show we're going to title Kathleen Kennedy Rocks. Doesn't matter what their show is about. That's what the show is going to be called until she comes knocking.
KK Rocks. All right. Well, before we wrap this up, we have one last question for you guys. Now, what piece of advice would you give any newbies coming to any Star Wars celebration? So, Rick, let's start with you.
This will be advice for myself and for others. don't let the crowds and the lines stress you out. Realize that you're going to go in and miss things and just enjoy the experience. Find the things that you can find, and everything is going to be new and fun. I mean, the Band-Aid thumb wrestling was one of the most amazing things we did there. It was a blast, and there was no crowd for that. There was no line.
But the last person...
did Eliza beat the last person?
She went like five rounds and lost in the final round.
Wow.
She was beating adults. She took everyone out.
Wow.
That sounds like Eliza.
Yep, pretty much.
All right,
you don't want to face her on the ice.
No.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Trisha, how about you?
My my advice is to plan, then prioritize, and then be prepared to go with the flow.
Those are some awesome, that's awesome advice.
Yeah.
I would second everything there. Richard, what about you?
Don't wear backpacks and you'll be on my good side.
Big giant backpacks.
Yes.
And then what did Leland Chi bring out, show us at last celebration?
On the Celebration Anaheim guide that we had done through the tips for everyone, I said, if you're going to have a backpack, make sure it's flat and just don't, nothing that's, you're going to house a tent in.
Right.
And
then also
by all means, please bring breath mints. Mm-hmm. And he showed up there with no backpack and breath mints.
And he showed us breath mints. And we're like, why are you showing us breath mints? And then he's like, I listened to your show. That was really funny.
I don't mean to, you know, sound, what's the word I'm looking for? I don't want to sound, you know, like, oh, you have bad breath and you stay away.
No.
But it was like more of those, you're going to be in such close proximity to people. And you'll find people will want to talk to you more if you have a breath mint on you.
And bring okay, my
oh,
one
boy.
Advice.
Oh, boy. All right, everyone take a note.
Bring that spray deodorant.
Bring some Axe body deodorant.
Like, yeah, no, like spray. Like the stuff that you spray with the good smell. I forget what it's called. Is that what it's called?
Febreze?
Well, kind of like Febreze, but like for your body. And because sometimes you're sitting next to someone who may not smell that good.
Because, you know, showers are not always a priority.
And well, so...
we're actually kind of wrapping back around into the lineingup.net thing. And kind of half joking recently about like new kind of rules for membership. And one was knowing when was the last time you replaced your toothbrush.
There you go. Yeah, so you can spray yourself, but then you can also discreetly spray those people around you if you don't like the smell.
It's all misdirection. Hey, look, Kathleen Kennedy's over there. And squirt, squirt, squirt,
you're not
squirt,
caring,
squirt.
You don't have a fog machine on your costume. It's actually just a body spray.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, that's funny.
We'll go up and down the line spritzing people with Febreze.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, that's
you know,
it.
We just want everyone to
enjoy
smell
themselves.
Good and have nice breath and not to hit anyone else with
good.
A backpack.
Yeah.
There's some small people in that crowd.
All right, everyone. Well, thank you so much for joining us tonight. And Trisha, can you tell everyone where they can find you on social media?
Yeah, I'm at Fangirl Cantina pretty much everywhere.
Awesome. Awesome. All right, Rick and Eliza.
Well, Eliza does not have her own social media outlet yet.
Okay. What kind of dad are you?
I found an awful lot about her by following me. I'm Kilted Jedi Rick, and that's all one word with R-I-C instead of I don't use a K, sorry. you can find me pretty much everywhere there. And, of course, we are still doing the lineingup.net presents Q&A show. It's pretty semi-regular right now, but it'll pick up as we get closer and closer to the next line.
Awesome. All right, you guys. Well, thank you so much for joining us. And always remember,
Never land on Alderaan.
Never land on Alderaan.
Shout outs, Skywalker shout outs. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out?
Shout out.
Who was photoballed?
Shout out.
Who was shared a post?
Shout out.
All right, so who shouted out at us this week?
Okay, well, let's start with Twitter, at SkywalkingPod. So Amy Wishman Nolan tweeted, check out the classic Marvel Star Wars goodness my daughter received as a birthday gift. And she posted a picture with that tweet of her daughter holding up a comic that was almost as big as her daughter.
Yeah, this big comic was released in 1978.
Wow.
So they got all six issues and put them into three super issues.
Wow.
No, you know what? I'm sorry. Two large size jumbo Marvel comics.
Uh-huh.
And then they reprinted all of them into one big giant super bonus issue.
Of course.
So pretty much you had to buy it like four or five times.
So is this the one that Randy says
yes.
he uses?
Yes. This
okay.
is what Randy uses, yes.
Nice. So she got that.
This was the one that he had when he was a kid.
Okay.
So this
so is that like printed on what, 11 by 17
no, this
or
is like
24 by.
I want to see like 15 inch. Oh, right over here. Check this out.
Oh.
Check this out.
Okay.
I happen to have right here.
Oh my goodness.
A giant super holiday grab bag.
Oh.
Issue.
Okay.
This was the holiday issue with all the Avengers on it. You know, go get a ruler in the drawer to your right.
Okay.
It's amazing what I have in the office here.
Yeah.
So this is.
All right. So it is. Width, it is 10 inches. by over a foot. So 12. So
it's like 14 inches.
Yeah. 10 by 14. Oh, wow.
Yeah. So who out there had these super giant Marvel comics?
Of course, when you open it up, you know, it's over 20 inches yeah. wide. It's like 2 feet.
Yeah. I used to live on these. Loved these as a kid.
Goodness.
So the fact that her little girl got one of these,
uh-huh.
and I don't think they ever reprinted them.
Oh.
Yeah, that's a pretty good birthday gift. Was it birthday? Birthday.
Yes. Yes, it's yeah. a birthday gift.
So Amy's daughter, hang on to that one.
Yeah.
Put it in a Mylar bag. And don't put it in direct sunlight.
Nice. All right. Well, let's move on to our next tweet. This is not a tweet. I apologize. This is from our Skywalking Through Neverland Facebook group, which has really taken off. We have over 200 members now. And if you want to join, anyone can join who wants to. Just search Facebook for Skywalking Through Neverland group, and it'll probably pop up and you can request to join. And there's some awesome discussions going on there. It's a really great place for you to get to know other Skywalkers, not just Richard and I, but, you know, everyone who listens to the show. And there's been some impromptu meetups, too, through that group.
Yeah?
Yeah, like Donald and Joey met up.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, and I know some people have been requested, like some people were at Walt Disney World and were like, hey, are you here? You know, so it's really neat. So several of you posted in this group and used the word tangential as a nice nod to last week's episode. How do you say that word, Richard?
Tangential.
Tangential.
Yes.
Very good. I've been practicing all week.
Yeah, so John Fowler and Chris Shepherd, thank you so much for using that word in your in your posts. And also in our Facebook group, Rick Peralta posted, I hereby declare that Friday at Star Wars Celebration Orlando should be Skywalkers of the Weekday, which prompted a bunch of comments, like 20 plus comments from Skywalkers who haven't been Skywalkers of the Week. So, duly noted. Okay, that's good to know.
Give us time.
Yes, yes. There's 50 weeks. How many weeks before Star Wars Celebration Orlando?
I'm looking for my calculator.
Uh-oh.
Can't find it. Well, that's a lot of weeks.
It's a lot of weeks. So there's some
That's
some
44
good...
weeks.
Okay.
44?
I don't know. You're the math guy.
All right. 44 yeah. weeks, give or take one or two.
Yeah. So I thought that was amusing. So thank you, Skywalkers, for posting. And then Lori Lazotte, she posted a picture right after that made me laugh out loud. It was Kylo Ren, you know, without his mask on in that brooding face in the snow. And she had superimposed the words, not Skywalker of the Week over that. And yeah, that made me giggle for like 5 minutes.
I timed her. It really was 5 minutes.
So,
well, Kylo, don't worry. You have 44 more weeks, but you've got to reach out to be a Skywalker of the Week.
Yeah, you got to reach out. You got to share the show with someone. Mm-hmm. And in fact, if you make someone press subscribe on iTunes or Google Play Music and let us know that, that's a really good way for you to be Skywalker of the Week.
That's not how the Force works.
Yes, it is. That's how we get up in the ratings.
I stand corrected.
If more people subscribe to our show on iTunes, that's how the algorithm works. I do my research. All right. Well, speaking of Skywalker of the Week, should we tell everyone who is the Skywalker of the Week?
First, let's let him hear the jingle as composed by Rob Dellinger.
John Fowler, John Fowler, John Fowler.
So, John Fowler, you've been really interacting with us in our Facebook group. You also posted this tweet. If you're not listening to Skywalking Through Neverland, I seriously question your sanity.
Now, this that show, is worthy.
This show is always making me laugh. And you actually put the... You know, you quoted our tweet that has a link to our episode. So thank you so much, John. We really appreciate that.
That really is a worthy tweet.
Yes.
All right. So if you want your Skywalker of the Week, Kylo Ren, are you listening?
That's right. So share a tweet of this show, share a Facebook post of this show, interact with us, or make someone who isn't already press that subscribe button.
But if Rob Dellinger does make you Skywalker of the Week, Kylo, he's only going to do it as Ben Solo.
Ben!
And that will be composed by Rob Dellinger,
the John Williams of podcasting.
And now let's talk to Mark Daniel of Star Wars Celebration Europe and Inside Disney Parks.
Be our guest, be our guest. Put our podcast to the test. Gather round the microphone and we will do the rest.
It takes one man to get the crowds at Star Wars Celebration, or at the most recent Star Wars Run Disney Half Marathon in Orlando, whipped up into a frenzy, and his name is Mark Daniel.
Now Mark brings his style of humor and energy to the Disney Parks blog, where he is now the co-host of the brand new video series Inside Disney Parks, which features the latest news and top stories from Disney parks and resorts around the world.
Everyone get ready for Mr. Mark Daniel!
Wow, thank you. Hey, everybody. Oh, man. That was a great intro. Thank you.
You're welcome. They're going wild over here.
I can hear it. Wow. Thank you. Thanks for having me, guys. I really appreciate it. It's great to be back on Skywalking Through Neverland.
That's right. You were just on episode 77. I say just, but that was like a year ago.
Yeah. Right.
Talking about Star Wars weekends.
Time flies when you're having fun.
Absolutely.
Now, for those Skywalkers who didn't hear you on that episode, where you and DJ Elliot were talking about Star Wars weekends, tell us about your Disney and Star Wars fandoms.
Oh, all right. Well, I am Mark Daniel. I usually work with DJ Elliot. We do all of the Star Wars celebrations globally, and it's a blast. We host the main stage. So we first started in Orlando with Jay LaGaia. He was hosting the main stage, and then we moved on to James Arnold Taylor, and then we went to Europe, and we hosted with Warwick Davis, and that's been a blast. So I am by heart an improviser and a stand-up comedian, and as you guys said so eloquently, a warm-up host to get the crowd in a frenzy. I come out before the main shows, and I just have fun with the audience. I won't call them an audience because they are fans, and they're a family, basically.
Yeah.
And, get them hyped up. We have fun. I interview them. I film them. I do giveaways. I do stand-up comedy. And I even do like funny videos, and I'll play the funny videos. And it's just a Star Wars celebration is just a huge playground for me. And from there, I went on to do the first ever Star Wars half marathon, The Dark Side, which you guys were a part of.
The Dark Side Challenge.
That's right. Yes. We were a part of, but we never crossed paths. They had you so early, and we were not as early.
Yeah.
Not for lack of trying.
Not for lack of trying. You tried. You'd probably have to get up like 2 days before to get there.
Yeah. Yeah, no kidding.
Asking a lot. But
that's right.
I did follow you guys on Twitter, and I saw everything you guys were doing. So I felt like I was along with you guys for the whole run.
Aww.
I just didn't get any, like, I didn't have to eat a banana afterwards or anything. My thumb did all the running. I was just scrolling through your pictures.
Oh, there you go. Your finger did.
Mm-hmm.
So I was on Disney Parks blog, and I saw that, you know, Disney was releasing this new video series inside Disney Parks, and I click, and I play, and who do I see but you? It's a
Surprise!
Friendly face. I know. So can you tell us a little bit about this and how you started, or how you got to host it?
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, this is brand new. This is brand new stuff. Mm-hmm. It's Inside Disney Parks. It's a newscast. It gives you the best of Disney storytelling for your whole family. And what's cool about the show is we try to tell you exactly what's going on in the parks right now around the world. So it's high paced. We try to give you a lot of information. And so that's a lot of fun. But I started hosting what they call for Disney Parks Blog. I don't know if you ever saw it. Disney Parks Blog.
The live?
Has the live streams. Yeah.
Yes.
Have you seen those?
I know that you guys do them, and I've watched a couple of them, and you've been doing a bang-up job with that.
Yeah, so I started doing those live streams, and it's a lot of fun. And the cool thing about the live streams is, like, for instance, we did Fantasmic. So a lot of people who haven't seen Fantasmic or they've seen it before, we do the live streams. What's unique about the live streams is we actually have a couple different cameras. Mm. So you get some different camera angles within it. And we also give you a little extra. Before the show, I usually interview sometimes like the show director. So you get to talk to the show director about the show that you're about to watch and get a couple of inside tips and facts and what's been added and what's been taken away. And also Jen Fickley Baker, who's also a content manager for Disney Parks Blog. She will come on and talk to you. And sometimes you can even like get little real cool screensavers that you can't get anywhere else for watching. So, yeah. So we give you a couple little extra things. So I started doing that, and they were really working on the show and really wanting to give the Disney fans something else along with the Disney Parks Blog. That felt like, oh, this is exciting. It's a lot of energy. We can look into the parks. We can see some exclusive content. And also, take it a little bit to YouTube.
Right.
And that's what that does. It kind of takes you over to YouTube because they also do their own little stories. Each one of these content creators, like Victoria Lim, Jen Fickley Baker, Stephen Miller, Aaron Glover over at Disneyland, and they put them on YouTube. But what's cool about Inside Disney Parks is while we're talking, little pop-ups will come up. And if you want to learn more about it, you can click on it and you'll see a whole video dedicated to what we just talked about.
Ah, so yeah. In true Disney fashion, it's promoting itself, like,
yes.
Like synergistically, I
yes.
suppose.
Yes. We want to cover all mediums.
Yeah, yeah. So now is this going to be a weekly series?
Right now it's going to be a bi-weekly series.
Okay.
Yeah, so because the Disney Parks blog is daily. I mean, they've always got information. So so right now we are going every 2 weeks.
Okay.
That could change. It all depends. And if you know people watch it and they love it and they can't get enough of it, we might say, you know what? They might say, let's do it weekly. So right now we're slated for every 2 weeks.
Okay.
Well, this episode one has already gotten 42,000 views, so that's not bad. That's very good.
That is fantastic, and I've read a few of the comments, and people are pretty excited about it. And I have a co-host. Her name is Elise South, and she's a lot of fun. She's a fun co-host. I had never met her before, but they worked us together a lot before we even had the first episode. So we did a lot of things together. Just to get us comfortable working with one another. And that was a lot of fun.
I'm guessing you were a shoo-in from all your experience working with Disney and Lucasfilm to do this show. Did you learn anything new while doing this first episode, even with your vast knowledge of Disney and Star Wars?
Oh, yeah. I learned a lot. That's why I love the show. It's a dream show for me because just like you guys, I love Disney. And to be doing a show where they tell you the brand new things that are happening and you're reading the paper and you're like, try not to be excited. You're like, oh my goodness. Oh, really? We're doing this. So yeah, I learned a lot. I learned, just doing a show like that is different too. You know, you're keeping the excitement up, which is easy to do, but, you're in the parks. We're really in the parks.
Right.
So we're in Florida and it's hot. You know? I learned how to keep smiling.
Yeah, I'll have to learn that one from you because when I start sweating, it's like, okay, all the smiles go out of my face.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. But, you know, you're at Disney and you're talking about some really cool things. One thing I like about the show is, like, we really talk about the storytelling of Disney. So what's unique is even when I'm talking about or just reading the script of what we're talking about, they could say, well, you know, this new show is opening, but they will talk about the idea of the show or the story of the show. Mm. So that's always a lot of fun because Disney's really big into story.
Yeah.
Luigi's Rollicking Roadsters, right?
Right.
When we were reading that, we're like, oh, cool. It's like bumper cars. But then as we were talking about it, we're saying, no, they're throwing a party. And each car, they're coming to the party and they all have their own personality. So while you're riding in the car, you're in this car, and he has this personality. He does this. He or she does this. So it's really cool to be like, oh, wow. You know, you get that extra little bit of information mm-hmm. that you probably only get if you actually got to the ride and saw it.
Right.
And
right.
experienced it, you know.
Now, being an improv comic, do you find it hard to stay on script, or do you just want to just go in so many different directions because you're so excited and you want to ask so many questions?
Oh, yeah. You know, I get really excited. you know, we do some interviews and they keep it, they let us improvise a lot, especially like, you know, the cool thing is we can, when we're talking about something, it's pretty much scripted because this is the wording that, you know, this has been created by, you know, Imagineers and, you know, designers and engineers and all these people. So there's some things you definitely have to get out there to tell that story. But for the most part, yeah, it's a lot of fun. And yeah, we cut a lot. We joke around a lot. Like, on our YouTube channel, on my own YouTube channel, Elise and I just totally mess around that you won't see on Inside Disney Parks, but they allow us to put it up on YouTube. So,
oh, wow.
Yeah, so we tell bad jokes. We just have a lot of fun.
So okay, so your YouTube channel, is that, what is the name of it? Just so we...
It is LOL, the number 4, Mark Daniel, MarkDaniel, like okay. Two first names. Yeah.
So basically the outtakes are on that channel.
Yeah, well, I won't say the outtakes, but mostly us kind of messing around.
Okay.
And I'm guessing it's all family friendly.
Oh, of course, of course. Yeah, of course. Well, there was that one episode that we... No, I'm just kidding. Nah, it is all family friendly, yeah. Especially if if we're, you know, you see the cameras behind us and you know we were filming inside Disney Parks and now we're messing around.
Right. The one segment I really loved on the episode one was that segment you had on the Tree of Life.
Mm-hmm.
And to be honest, I thought that was a real tree.
Oh, what? Really? Yeah. And did you see, you know, a cool thing about inside Disney Parks, we have a touch of nostalgia. So we'll go back.
Yeah.
Show you some cool stuff. So that episode, we showed you how it was put together, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 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 I did love that part where you do, like you just said, you do a lot of what's going on in the news, but then you'll take a segment and go, hey, you know, let's take a trip back down memory lane and visit how this was made or something. We'll review this from way back when. And
sounds kind of like our show.
Those copycats.
I know, right?
But yeah, you know what? I don't think I ever really thought twice about it, but I think just subconsciously, I thought it was a real tree.
Oh, wow. I mean, it looks so good.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, and they keep, you know, they keep adding to it, too. Oh. There's some new animals on the tree. Another thing, I don't know if you, when you guys came for the marathon for Run Disney, did you guys go to Disney's Animal Kingdom?
Yeah,
we did.
And we ran right through it.
Well, towards the front, they added, like, new routes and everything. I mean, I won't say new animals, but they added more animals.
Okay.
There's moss on it and everything. It's really cool.
Now, I might be just making this up, but did I see BB-8 in there? So I am just making that up, right?
I don't know. I think that was a fruit. I think it was a fruit that looked like, I think it was a mango. No. I haven't heard
orange.
That. I mean, it
could have been a honeydew.
Yeah, it could be a honeydew. Yeah, honeydew and an orange stuck together.
There you go.
So can you give us a sneak preview about what episode 2 is going to entail?
What can I talk about? Well, yeah, I can tell you that when you guys were here, Disney Springs hadn't opened yet fully.
That's right.
So Disney Springs, a lot of the shops have opened. The spring is open. It's beautiful. So we got some, we're going to be talking a little bit about, we're going to take you inside and you can see some of the beauty of Disney Springs.
Wow. So does everyone who watches gets 2 free Sprinkles cupcakes? I've been seeing?
Yeah. Yeah. But the deadline was 2 seconds ago.
So
you guys missed it.
I'm surprised they let you do anything at Disney Springs, or maybe they would have tackled you to the ground.
Right. Well, he went through media relations.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you went through media relations. Because when we tried to record at Disney Springs, we had 2 big, you know, Paul Blarts tackling us and taking our microphones and putting us in Disney jail. Now, that part there, I did just make up.
In the Disney jail.
But they did say, oh, sir, you cannot be recording a podcast right over here.
Can't be using your microphones.
And I said, hey, I'm Mark Daniel.
That'll get you kicked out quickly. That's the fastest way to get out. Yeah, we know a guy. So we know a mouse.
Now, I don't want to bring up the past at all, but right now would have been the time when Star Wars weekends would be going on.
Yeah.
So let's switch gears to that. And how did you feel when they told you, hey, Mark, you got to sit down for this next part because Star Wars weekends, it's just not coming back?
Yeah, you know, when we did this last Star Wars weekends, James Arnold Taylor was in. We had some great, we had the fireworks show when he was hosting it. And I was his understudy, actually. I learned it. I never did it because it's good. If I don't do it, that means that he stayed healthy the whole time.
Right.
But yeah, at the end, they told us, hey, you know, this is probably going to be the last Star Wars weekends. But we were sad, but this is before we knew something was coming. This is before the big announcement.
Right.
It was all the rumors, and we were like, oh, well, you know, it's kind of sad. And they kind of tricked us. They told us, you know, we knew that we were like, oh, the studios is changing its theme and we're going to change the name. But we still didn't know that, you know, Star Wars Land was coming, you know. So when they made that big announcement, we were like, whoa, Star Wars Land is coming. And to be honest with you, it's just because I'm at the studios now, you know, I also do the Indiana Jones stunt spectacular. And there just wouldn't be any room because there's so much construction going on.
Right.
You know? So it's sad that it's not coming back, But right now, it's like it's Star Wars Weekends right now, to tell you the truth, Richard and Sarah, because right now there's stuff going on. I mean, you got Captain Phasma with her stormtroopers marching daily. You know, we've got a brand new fireworks show that's coming up soon. Mm-hmm. There's a fireworks show going on right now, but they're going to actually redo it. It's going to be like the biggest fireworks display in studio's history coming very shortly.
Wow.
Yeah, we saw your interview with one of the creative officers, and he was talking about how they're going to redo the Star Wars fireworks with all the projections.
Yeah. Like they're doing at Disneyland right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's going to be intense, and it's cool. They have these right now. If you go to the studios, you can see these two big pillars they just built. Oh. So something big is coming. So you know, kind of Star Wars is happening. We got Launch Bay. So it kind of feels like Star Wars Weekends is going on right now anyway.
Right. You just don't have like the VIPs wondering about.
Yeah, you don't have the VIPs and stuff.
Well, Mark is wondering about.
That's true. That is true. I am wondering.
Now, do you know, did they give you any information about like when Star Wars Land is built? Will there resume Star Wars Weekends?
Any insider info you can leak?
Ooh. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I don't even, I can't tell you. It's just so fresh.
Just nod your head if you have some juicy information.
I'm nodding it as fast as I can. Do you hear the marbles shaking around?
Oh, good talk to Mark afterwards.
Interesting.
Too bad this is a video.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Darn it.
I'm writing all the stuff down. I'm writing all the secrets down. I'm holding it up to the computer.
Oh.
There's Bob Iger's phone number. All right, good.
Yep.
And that's 555-5555. Hey, yes. Now wait a minute.
No, it's a LA number.
Oh, okay. Must be a new area code somewhere in East LA.
Right.
It's Star Wars Land area code.
How much have you seen behind the scenes, like with construction? Like over here, we can look over the fence. And see the construction.
Parking structure, you can pretty much see the whole land.
The whole thing.
The way ours is like they have a beautiful wall up with a beautiful concept art. That's what you can see. Because, you know, it's starting from, to give you a vision of it, you know where Rider's Stop is at Disney's Hollywood Studios?
Right, yeah.
Yes.
It basically stops right there. So that's when you used to walk into New York Street.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it stops right there. So there's a wall up with a beautiful concept art of the land that's coming with the Millennium Falcon flying through the air and everything. And so it stops right there. You don't see anything yet, you know, because all the facades are still there. So they're just kind of taking down things that you can't really tell because the wall's up.
Right. So as soon as stuff starts building up above the wall, then I'm sure you'll be able to see things. But that's going to be a while.
That's going to be a while. Yeah, it's going to be a while because, you know, it's all of New York Street. Remember how big New York Street was?
Yeah, it was huge.
Yeah, especially with Star Wars Weekend. So you had New York Street and then you had the Premiere Theater where they had some of the shows for Star Wars Weekends.
Right.
And then you had Honey, I Shrunk the kids. No, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, the playground.
Oh, right.
Honey, I Shrunk the Kids playground. And then you had Backlot Tour. And then you had Watto's Grotto.
Right.
And the AFI Museum. So you had all that stuff back there. And of course, the biggest chunk of that was Lights, Motors, Action.
Right.
Rest in peace, one of my favorite shows.
Oh, yeah, with Herbie the Love Bug.
Yes, with Herbie the Love Bug. And then Lightning McQueen came in after Herbie.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
yeah.
Progress.
So all that is, I believe, going to be all part of the new Star Wars Land, which is going to be amazing, I'm sure.
Did they give you a time frame as to when maybe this might be happening?
No, I don't have a time frame. I'm sure there is, but I haven't been in position to hear anything.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Well,
they're also doing Toy Story Land too. So.
All right.
Boy. Yeah. Well. Wow. Okay. Let's talk about something that you can talk about.
Yes.
Star Wars Celebration Europe.
Oh man, I'm excited about that.
Oh, you must be jumping every single morning out of bed going, woohoo, one day closer.
Yeah. I can't believe it. Yeah, I can't believe it. Going to London? I've never been to London.
Oh, cool.
Everyone there talks with an accent, just to let you know.
Really, I can't wait to get some fish and chips, meet Harry Potter.
Yes.
And go to Hogwarts.
Oh my gosh. If you ever see like groups of school kids wandering about London, like it's like, oh my gosh, this is like little Harry Potter.
When Sarah and I were there on our honeymoon. We saw these little groups of school kids and we just sat back giggling at them.
Yeah. Oh. they'd all be talking like this. Oh. What's going on up there? Oh, get your book out. You know, oh my gosh.
We're not laughing at them. We're laughing with them.
Yes.
With them. You're just like, you eat popcorn like you're watching an episode of movies.
Yeah.
A Prisoner of Azkaban.
They're so cute.
Now, the trial.
This is going to be you and DJ Elliot, right?
Yeah, me and DJ Elliot. We're coming to London. We're excited about it. The most exciting thing I got to tell you guys about, I'm excited about working with Warwick Davis again. He's going to be hosting the main stage. And Warwick Davis is one of the funny, and I do improv, I do stand up, I met comedians and all kinds. He's the funniest person I've ever met in my
life.
Warwick Davis is amazing to watch. Because sometimes when he did Star Wars Weekends, he actually does his own show also, right? Just like James Arnold Taylor did.
Mm-hmm.
And he gets people up on stage and he just, you know, and he tells his story about how he got into Star Wars. I don't know if you guys saw that.
Yes, we did.
Isn't it funny?
Yeah, he comes out as a director, right?
And so creative.
Yes.
Yes, and it's him. That's what I'm saying. He is just a funny person.
Wow.
And the first time I ever met him, to jump back really quick away from Star Wars, was I used to do a show called World Showcase Players at Epcot. And we were a trunk show, you know, like a Renaissance Fair kind of entertainment.
Oh.
And we'd come out, we'd do Romeo and Juliet, but we call it Romeo and Edna. And we'd get people from the crowd, and they would be Romeo and who's Juliet, but Edna for legal reasons. And and we'd do it. And one day, this is before I even got into Star Wars, doing Star Wars Celebration or anything, Warwick and his family, they were watching the show. And I look over, and he's giggling, and he's laughing. And I go, hey, guys, Warwick Davis is watching the show. And they were like, who's that? And I said, he was Wicket the Ewok. And I'm like the only Star Wars fan at this point in this little group. And they're like, what? I said, Wicket the Ewok. So afterwards, he watched the show and he came over and just told us how much he loved it. And he was laughing. And I've seen that. He's just a funny person. He likes comedy. And he just, you know, to be that funny, to really go back and just watch a show and really hang out afterwards and tell the actors, hey, you guys are funny.
Yeah.
Thank you for making me laugh. And you're like, we laugh at you all the time. Thank you for making us laugh.
Aww.
It's really cool. So I'm really excited to work with him. He makes everybody feel like they're part of the team. So I'm really excited about working with Warwick Davis again.
Cool.
Wow. What are you looking forward to the most other than working with Warwick Davis, but in terms of what you'll be doing?
I'll be doing some of the, one of the things I love is the cosplay contest. Mm-hmm. And I'll be helping host that.
Nice.
And the costumes are amazing. I mean, the fans, you know, you've seen it. They are amazing. And seeing the fan props are also just spectacular. The work they put into it. In Orlando, they had a life-size TIE fighter.
Yeah.
A life-size TIE fighter. I was like, okay.
Yeah.
It was awesome. So I'm excited to see a lot of those things. And what we're all excited about is, you guys know already, is that Kathleen Kennedy and Gareth Edwards are going to be talking about Rogue One.
Oh.
Yay.
So what kind of announcements do you think they're going to make in London?
At London?
Ooh, that's good. I mean, you know, now, you know, don't quote me on this.
Right.
But if you're asking my opinion,
yeah,
I would think... some Star Wars Land announcements.
Ooh.
Because, you know, when they come to Orlando, there's definitely, because they do it all the time, there's going to be a tie-in with Disney's Hollywood Studios, because that's where Star Wars lives right now.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely I would like to hear maybe a date for Star Wars Land.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they might talk a little bit more about some of the things you can experience. In the Star Wars land, maybe even what planet it's supposed to represent.
Mm-hmm.
I would also think they would do something with the next movie.
Yeah, a lot of the fans are complaining that they're already blowing everything, and there's nothing to announce in London. But yeah,
well, I'll tell you, you know, working with Disney and Star Wars, I'll tell you from experience, when they tell you something, it's time. So I can't say much more than that, than saying that they are not going to blow anything.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. They're not going to blow anything. It's like, no, they know what they're doing.
Yeah. Yeah. They know of the backlash that would happen if they didn't announce something big.
Yeah. They know what they're doing. You know, yeah, they know what they're doing. And everything they're saying, it's been, they've probably been like, okay, let's finally say it. Okay, let's finally say it. Right. So yeah, you know, I think there'll probably be a really cool tie-in from Celebration into the parks. There might be, again, I know nothing, but it could be some after parties at the parks.
Well, now you're talking about Celebration Orlando.
Yeah, right? Celebration Orlando. Yeah, okay. Sorry. Yeah, Celebration.
Yeah,
Orlando.
I hope so. Oh, that was so, like, one thing that's interesting about this podcast, you know, we're a Star Wars Disney podcast, nearly everyone who have become Skywalkers or who are our biggest fans or, you know, who we have interactions with every day, nearly everyone was at that last Tour to Endor party.
Wow. Yeah.
I bet if we look over some of our pictures, we'll see everybody in the background.
Like literally everyone I've talked to on a daily basis or tweet at, you know, they're like, they were all at that last Tour to Endor. It's like nuts.
Now everyone's talking about what kind of tie-in they're going to do next.
Yeah.
For
so
Star Wars Celebration.
We really hope that Orlando does that. Cause Anaheim, they didn't do any special.
Yeah. What a waste of an opportunity. It was there.
Mm-hmm.
Can you give us any kind of sneak preview as to what you and Elliot will be planning for Star Wars Celebration Europe? Some of your
London
warm-up antics.
Just more fun, just more silliness. You know, one of the things when I get out there, Elliot loves, he's going to have his music and he does some amazing videos. Mm. And what he does, he started doing, just filming everybody and playing it on the last day. When I go out there, it's really, I tend to just go out and have fun and just do whatever.
Well, you had all those videos.
Well, how can I put this? The videos were awesome, and I'm so glad I did them. But there is, how can I put this? With the new movies, I probably won't do any more videos per se. It might be just with classic characters, because one thing is that, you know, we want to keep the lore of the new characters very.
The integrity,
yeah, very much so, and they deserve it. Right. They really do deserve it. So, okay. So there's some red tape to get through if I wanted to do those kind of videos with me being part of the Disney brand,
right?
And Lucasfilm.
Okay.
The best way I can put it.
Okay.
So what you're saying is things are still in the works for you and DJ Elliot.
Yes. Yeah. But I can tell you, we're gonna have some fun.
Well, you did mention now the day before Star Wars Celebration, you are planning something?
Yeah, the day before we're doing, they have to do this thing, it's called, in London, hashtag Cantina.
It's called hashtag Cantina?
Yeah, it's called Cantina.
Okay.
But right now I think it's a hashtag Cantina to jump in on it, but I think it's, the website is www.thisiscantina.com.
Oh.
Yeah, and it's happening. It's a big fan celebration. It will support the Alzheimer's Society.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and it's at the iconic London O2 Arena at the Brooklyn Bowl.
Whoa.
So, oh, my goodness.
Yeah, it's like a big concert. So it's going to musically take you to a galaxy far, far away. So they asked Elliot and I to be there. I'll host it. He's going to supply some of the music, and there's going to be live bands. And
yeah, happening July 14th, as we're looking on the website right now.
Yeah, July 14th, yeah. They asked us to do it, and I jumped on it. It's like, yeah, we'll. Elliot called me up and was like, hey, Mark, this sounds pretty cool. So, again, I've never been to London, and I guess this O2 Arena, I guess the Beatles played there.
Oh, yeah, this is a huge arena. U2 plays there. Like, it's gigantic. Yeah.
Wow, there's a resume builder.
Yeah. So, yeah, I'm excited about that.
Oh, cool.
After Star Wars Celebration, we're going to jump over to Disneyland Paris.
Oh.
I myself am deeply jealous.
Now, are you doing that as like on the clock or just for fun?
Just for fun.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Oh, they won't take advantage and shoot any more of your new show inside Disney Parks over there?
Probably not the way I'm going right now, because that'll take a lot. They'll need a whole camera crew and stuff. I'm just kind of right after celebration, we're just hopping over there really quick.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, if you bring your own video camera and tape it yourself, then it becomes a tax write-off.
That's true. That is true. I like that. So I will do that.
All right. Well, I'm just doing some research here on the hashtag Cantina Party at the O2, and it looks like your tickets for general admission are £22.04.
There we go.
Cents. I don't know. £22.04. I don't know.
We need to call one of our English friends to convert that.
We need those school kids you were giggling at.
Yeah, like, hey, you guys are laughing at us? We ain't telling you squat.
That's
$1 million.
No, it's probably like $30-$35. I don't know what the exchange rate is right now.
Yeah,
but
I think it's like...
Yeah, it's like one
and a half, right.
Yeah.
It sounds right for a concert. Oh, and it's 18 and up, too, just so you know.
Oh, okay. Good to know.
And I'm sure they're going to be live streaming this.
Oh, I hope so. Well, I don't know about this one since it's for charity, but...
Right, okay. You're
listen, right. I'll live stream it. I will live stream it. At least a couple minutes. If they're not live streaming, I will let you guys know, and I'll at least live stream the opening.
Okay.
Yeah, you got to Periscope that.
Yeah, I was going to say, are you on Periscope? Is that where you live stream?
I was on Periscope, and then Facebook started the live stream, so I just hopped to Facebook live stream.
Oh, okay. And do you live stream from your own account or?
Yes.
Okay. So Mark Daniel. Okay. Yeah. That's good to know. Well, that brings us to our next question. If people want to get a hold of you or just say, hey, congrats, what you're doing, you know, where can people reach out to you on social media?
Oh yeah. Thanks for asking. Social media, like I said earlier, on YouTube is LOL, the number 4, Mark Daniel. So that's my YouTube channel. A lot of videos up there. And like I said, a lot of us climbing around on inside Disney Parks with me and Elise. I'm on Instagram. I put videos up on there, but a lot of pictures from Star Wars stuff and just my own comedy is LOL for life and the number 2. So it's LOL, the number 4, life and the number 2.
Right.
And then the Twitter is just at LOL, the number 4, life, the number 2.
Awesome.
So, LOL for life 2.
So you do things outside of Disney and Star Wars too, perish the thought.
Yeah, I do. I do an event called Playlist Live, which is an amazing event. It's where YouTube, everything on social media, YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, comes to life. So it's all these famous creators from YouTube and Instagram. It's the time where they can meet their fans and they actually have performances and stuff. So, you know, a lot of YouTubers are, maybe they do comedy or they sing or they dance. So there's a lot of performances there. And there's two main stages. So I do the second stage. I host the second stage.
Wow. Is this in Orlando?
This happens in Orlando, and there's one coming up in D.C. So there's two of them. One in Washington and one here in Orlando.
Wow. I mean, we have a YouTube channel, but we're like out of that YouTube circuit because we mostly focus on the podcasting. But that's really interesting to hear about.
Yeah, if you go to your website, there's a show calendar. You can find out where you're going to be next.
Yes, yes. It's a little defunct right now, but I need to keep it up. But yeah, it's best to go to my Instagram and Twitter.
Okay.
I've been really focusing on my YouTube, so my website has been lacking a little.
Okay. Yeah. Well, that's good to know.
Yeah. I'm trying to put up a video every Thursday. I'm putting up a video.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, if you ever come to LA, then we'll definitely be in the front row going, do the Star Wars Angry Bird game.
Definitely. Yeah. That was a lot of fun. Yeah,
absolutely.
I love that.
Yay.
All right, Mark. Well, thank you very much for all your insight and your thoughts and letting us know all about inside Disney Parks. We're definitely huge fans of yours.
Well, thank you. Hey, I really appreciate you guys having me on again. It was a pleasure to talk to both of you.
Awesome.
Well, the pleasure was all ours. I can guarantee you that. And we can't wait to follow your exploits at Star Wars Celebration Europe.
Yeah.
Yes. All right. You guys are coming, right?
No.
Well, I will see you in Orlando.
Okay.
If not.
Or at the Run Disney Half Marathon.
Oh.
Hopefully in January.
In January?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, if you could be there, that'd be fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to send you guys I'm gonna send you guys a personal live stream.
and a hello
from Warwick. I will do that for you guys. So I'll do that.
Oh. That'll be awesome.
Well, thank you very much. I think we have a new Skywalker of the week.
Right?
Skywalking through Neverland.
DK Publishing has been rolling out books faster than a Rathtar can gobble up a member of the Guavian Death Gang.
Long Beach Skywalker and Skywalking Through Neverland book analyst, ooh, Drew Kaplan, he is back to give us his thoughts on two new DK Publishing Star Wars books. First up, the 2016 Star Wars Character Encyclopedia, which has been updated and expanded to include characters from The Force Awakens, and it is written by Pablo Hidalgo and Simon Beecroft.
Hey, Drew.
Hey, Richard.
Now, you were just on episode 119 reviewing Star Wars Aliens,
yes,
and now you're back to tell us all about the updated Character Encyclopedia.
Yes.
So tell us all about this thick tome.
All right. Well, first, thank you, Richard and Sarah, for having me back on. So this book is over 200 characters, all from episodes 1 through 7 of the Star Wars feature films.
Okay.
It does not include Clone Wars, does not include Rebels, so you won't see Ahsoka Tano, you won't see Ezra, you won't see Asajj Ventress, but you will see, obviously, the Skywalkers, Luke and Leia, you'll see...
I was like, wait, us? I was confused.
Those.
Joey Pittman's
in
there.
I know.
In there.
Wait a minute.
Right.
Because right, some people will say, oh, it's the Skywalkers, you know, referring yeah, to us sometimes. Like, anyway.
Wow.
Okay. No, seriously. Yeah. Like, wow.
That's great. Yeah. So there, for the 218 characters, one page is dedicated to each character, whether they're this major character like Luke and Leia or Rey and Finn or Han Solo, or even if they're a really minor character who got like 2 seconds of screen time, whether it's Forlom and Zuckuss or even someone like Constable Zuvio, who I mention every time, who has no screen time. And so but they still are able to manage a really interesting set of facts about each of the characters. So for the big characters, whether you're a Skywalker, Han Solo, Rey or Finn, you probably get a sense of, it's more of like a summary, but for other characters who might really only ever be in the background of a shot, and that's it, they have zero lines, you still find out a real lot of information about them, which is really kind of fascinating.
Hmm.
For instance, I found out, I think really fascinatingly, the characters in Jabba's palace.
Right.
So there are people really you don't notice unless you're looking for them on the, like their 4th, 5th, or 50th viewing,
right,
of Return of the Jedi. But you find out, what really fascinated me was some of them were plotting to assassinate Jabba.
Right, yeah.
And that they actually ended up being disappointed that Luke killed, like, or Leia actually killed him.
Right.
And so one of them actually goes home and is like shamed because he was actually tasked to assassinate Jabba. So it gives you, for that, I think it really paints the colors of the Jabba's palace and the people around him really fascinatingly, way more than you get from simply watching the movie. So for me, the thing that I'm super stoked about, actually, after having read this book, is going back and watching all the movies and finding, like, seeing these random characters off in the background, even if they have no lines, but to get a better sense, a bigger picture of what's going on in these movies.
Well, now, how is this book organized? You said each character has a page.
Yes.
Is it, like, alphabetical?
Yeah, so it's alphabetical, okay, starting with... from everywhere, from Forlum to Zuckuss.
And you, poor Zuckuss. I'm last again?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Wow.
And so it's simply alphabetical, and there's really some random characters I wasn't even aware of.
Mm-hmm.
And but it also gives you a good sense of even the droids. So you don't necessarily always, obviously, see 3PO and R2-D2, BB-8. You think of those droids, but even random background droids, you get a sense of and what's going on. So that's, I found it really fascinating. It really painted a broader and I think a great picture of what's going on in these movies.
Okay.
Was there a character that you came across and you had no idea about their existence?
Yeah.
It's like, where have we seen this one?
Yeah, there were a few of them, but the one that most sticks out in my mind is this random small green creature in Jabba's palace. Oh, here we go. Rapper Toonie. Okay, I had never even heard of him. I really don't know that I even... looking at Sarah's face.
I have his action figure.
Wow.
Really? Yes.
Wow. Okay, I didn't even know... I was not aware of his existence. So, yes, I see Sarah's quizzical face. It's... Wait.
Yeah, I'm like, was he only in the special edition?
Special edition.
Okay.
Replaced Max Rebo. They came back with the new band headed by this guy.
There we go.
Okay. See, I did know a little something. See,
all right. All right. So that's one character I wasn't aware of. Yeah.
Now, Rappertuni is right next to Rathtars.
Yes. Rathtars. Rathtars you can't miss if you've seen the movies. Yes. You're very aware of their existence.
And Rancors.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So they like the creatures in our names.
Yeah. Okay. So it's actually, not just really characters, but they do include creatures.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Creatures.
Which I guess is a character, but something like a Rancor, I wouldn't think would be in the book like that.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Now I have a question.
Yes.
So you as an adult, you enjoyed this book?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So for kids, like what age range do you think this would be good? Like what's the youngest that could probably read this?
Youngest. Maybe as young as 7, 8.
Okay.
By 10 for sure, it's definitely readable. And teenagers of all sorts of teenagers can definitely read this. It's not a
exclusive. young kids book.
Yeah, yeah. It's definitely not for, you know, 5, 6 years old per se, but it's great for other kids.
Okay.
Which age do you think they were really targeting in on?
People of all ages. I mean, it's great for, you know, whether you're 15 or 75. It's an easy read. It's facts about the characters, the creatures, the droids, and it's insightful.
Well, yeah, it looks like it's nicely, like each page is kind of in little bites of information that like kids could really wrap their brains around.
Yeah. So there's like a header intro for each of the characters and then little bits of information.
Fun
facts and maybe a scene in which they were involved and that tells you about their character more broadly.
That's nice.
Now, if you have the other books like the Ultimate Star Wars or Everything You Need to Know.
Absolutely Everything You Need to Know. Yeah.
Which, when they do a revised edition of that, they got to change that title.
I know, right? it's too hard to tweet.
Good point.
There you go.
Good point.
Takes up the whole Twitter 140 characters, damn it.
I think they would know this. Now, if you already have those other books, is this one worth getting?
I've only seen the Ultimate one, and I still think this adds
reach
stuff.
Right over there, you can get the absolutely everything you need to know.
Yes.
I could. I would imagine this still probably adds some stuff. I haven't, not having read those, I can't tell. And also, I don't know what they, aside from The Force Awakens, I don't know what's necessarily different about the original version of this book either, before it got expanded and updated with Pablo Hidalgo.
Okay.
I think I did read somewhere online that they had taken actually some characters out that they had originally put in for spatial considerations.
Right,
wow.
Right.
That's interesting.
Yeah. You have to make some hard decisions.
They need to do one that includes the Ewok movies, the holiday special, the droids and Ewoks series,
the
and
TV
the Clone
stuff.
Wars and Rebels.
Well, I think this was going for even the canon TV stuff being omitted. I think they were going for really trying to hit people who are familiar with the movies. So even, I guess, the more hardcore Star Wars fans who've seen Rebels, Clone Wars, and read the books, comic books, this still is interesting, right? It's not just for the hoi polloi. It's not just for the every folk Star Wars fan. It's even for the more interested Star Wars fans. There's facts you can discover and find out about these characters. But I definitely do think, as far as audience wise, it's meant, you know, even if you're a casual Star Wars fan, you can find what's going on with these characters and who's involved, and it can be a gateway into Clone Wars and Rebels.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I think this is a gateway into the spinoff books.
Yeah,
into the TV properties and the possibilities are endless.
Yeah. But I do want to say, when it comes to the appearances, so they make mention of each of these characters, creatures, droids, appearances. They mention not only, you know, whether they were in episode 2, 5, whatever, but also if they were in Clone Wars or Rebels. So they do acknowledge the existence of both of those series, and they even reference for certain characters. So just two quick examples. So Adi Gallia, so it mentions that she died at the hands of Savage Opress. So now Savage Opress is not in this book because he's a Clone Wars exclusive, but it's obviously acknowledging it's still a canon property, but she's still in it. And another thing I want to point out is Boba Fett's description includes something that happened in one of the 2015 comic books about his first job for Darth Vader was to go find who this young pilot was who destroyed the Death Star. And so that it's interesting that they're bringing in these other canonical media. They just are not, if you're a character in anything else, whether you're, you know, Savage Opress, Asajj Ventress, you're not going to get mentioned in here.
Gotcha. Hmm. Okay, yeah. that's good to know.
Yeah.
Now, what is your overall critique of this book? Do you like the way it was laid out? Do you think maybe they could have brought it up to another reading level?
The reading level, I thought it was totally appropriate. Unless you're looking for a really, you know, intellectual endeavor, this was really solid. And it was, I like the alphabetical layout. It's a good number of characters. Could they have included more characters? Sure. But I think this is a lot, and I certainly learned a lot about a lot of characters that I was really not aware of, and so it was great.
All right. Anything else you want to add about this book?
Yeah. So in conclusion, I mentioned it earlier, but I really want to strongly conclude that it really makes me want to go back and watch episodes 1 through 7 again to really get a sense of who that character in the background or that other character in the background is and what's going on. So it's providing me with a richer watching experience for the future.
Yeah, okay. It's kind of like Tales of the Mos Eisley Cantina or Tales from Jabba's Palace after you read all the backstories. Like, oh, I want to really go into and watch it again and find out and really look at those background characters and go, I know where you're going after this.
Yeah,
or where what led you to this. So that's great.
Yeah.
Now let's talk about Star Wars The Force Awakens Incredible Cross-Sections.
Yes.
Now, I unfortunately did not get a chance to look at this book. So tell us.
I could bring it back in from the car.
You know what? That's why we have you here.
Okay.
To tell us all about this.
It's a great book. So it's a coffee-sized book. It's tall. It's wide. It's actually quite thin, but it's really easily to pick up because of that. And it features 13 vehicles from The Force Awakens and cross-sections. And it's, you know what? I'm trying to figure out who the precise audience is for it because it's a nice, interesting blend. You've got these really technical specifications of, you know, this compartment or this hatch. For most fans, that might be a little too technically oriented.
Me.
Right. And even for me, for the most part, although there were some interesting aspects, like on the cargo hauler that Han Solo and Chewbacca are on, that there's like some cargo compartment they just can't figure out how to open. You know, like some random things.
Wow.
But these 13 vehicles are all in The Force Awakens in one way or another, whether that's obviously Millennium Falcon, the TIE Fighters, oh my gosh.
Kylo's
shuttle, right, the command shuttle.
Love that ship.
Yeah, it's really cool. And it also explains why the wings fold the way they do upon landing. Can I just share it?
Yeah, okay,
the reason is that it provides better protection because apparently the height of the sort of the middle column of the command shuttle has a lot of communications array and stuff like that. And so when the wings fold up, they provide security. It's like a shielding of sorts. So it's really because when you're landed, there's a greater sense of vulnerability.
Right.
And so when you fly, you don't need that as much.
Interesting.
So there are definitely a lot of these interesting technical specifications that can seem a little too tedious, but when you start reading around, they are really fascinating and give you a sense of why certain ships move or do what they do or why they're shaped like they do.
So the author is Jason Fry, and it was illustrated by Kemp Remillard.
Yeah.
I'm going to say it that way.
Yeah.
But yeah, so, and I mean, these illustrations are gorgeous. Like, they took a lot of time.
Now, would you be interested in a book like this had we not asked you to review a book like this?
I would not have. This is actually my first cross-section book.
Oh.
Because I usually just, you know, from afar, look at them and find that, not actually having open it, just, you know, with my prejudice, say, hey, you know, it's just all these random technical specifications. How do they actually affect the movie or my experience? Once I actually opened it, read it, there were a lot of really actually more fascinating, more than just like, oh, they couldn't open this cargo container. Right. So, for instance, the First Order Stormtrooper transport, it has different reasons or why certain things are shaped the way that they are positioned. And you find out that it can hold 2 squads of 10 troopers each and why they do what they do. So there are these fascinating elements to the ships. That's one part. So that's the more tedious piece. The fascinating thing, I think, is that each of the ships or the transport, whatever it is, the vehicles all have a few different paragraphs written about them. And that I actually think is great for a broader audience. So whether you're a hardcore Star Wars fan, not even interested in any of the technical specifications, it's really great. And even if you're just a casual Star Wars fan or someone who watches The Force Awakens, you're just randomly curious about what's going on, what's with the Millennium Falcon looking the way it does, what about this huge ship, what about this, what about the, you know, the Resistance transport, why are they the way they are? it provides lots of really fascinating information about that. And right. I think that's meant for a broader audience.
I have a question.
Yes.
What about the, what does it have to say about the Millennium Falcon's new radar dish?
It does say that it mentions it. I don't recall exactly what it says about it, but it does mention it. And it also mentions some other adjustments since you know, 30 years.
Okay.
So for one, it was like upon Han and Leia getting married, they installed some sort of kitchen on the Millennium Falcon. So that was neat.
Now you're speaking my language.
Yeah, there we go.
And more of a Han thing or a Leia thing, do you think?
Yeah.
Judging by the way Sarah nests in here, when we first started to go out, she gravitated toward the kitchen.
Nice.
Yeah, I can put that nice. Together. Yeah, I kind of think this title is misleading, because when I saw cross-section, I was thinking, we're going to learn all about the engine capacity and how many airbags it has, and it's fun to know, but not on my high priority list.
Right. And I think for that smaller segment of the population, it definitely is great. That's really for Jason Fry doing all that stuff, which is really fun. But the paragraphs that I mentioned, those are really fascinating for any fan.
Okay. Right.
And curious about the movie and why the vehicles are what they are, or how they're shaped and so forth.
Yeah, because some of the cross-section books I have picked up, I've looked at it, and they've taken off a panel of an X-Wing and tell you what coupling goes to what and how much unleaded the tank can hold. And
it's like, I'm never going to have an X-Wing, so I don't really need to know this info.
Right.
Yeah, and my head can only hold so much information.
Right.
So I thought, maybe, here you go, Drew. Look at this book for us.
Yeah.
But now knowing all this, I kind of want the book back.
Right, and they do have some, if you are interested in that hardcore technical stuff, they do that with the First Order TIE Fighter, and then they even have a Special Forces First Order TIE Fighter, and they show how they're different. I mean, that's great for those type of people. Mm-hmm. It's perfect. In addition, for the rest of us, they're the really cool, really helpful explanations of why these ships move in the way that they do.
Okay.
Can you give us an idea of what the ships are that are covered?
So you have, of the 13 ships, so some are more familiar. The largest of these, by the way, is the Finalizer.
Oh.
And that is actually really fascinating because it's already a coffee table-sized book, so it's large, but it also has fold-out flaps.
Whoa.
So it's a massive, when you open it, all of it, it's massive to really give you a sense of just how incredibly large that ship is.
Wow.
And to show you everything going on. And then, actually, one of the things it mentions about that is it uses some of the Clone Wars technology about how they used to have those Republic ships. So that there are a couple of hearkening backs to the Republic and the Clone Wars, stuff like that.
But for those who don't know, tell us what the Finalizer is.
The Finalizer is the massive ship. It's kind of like an Imperial Star Destroyer, except it's better. And it's the ship that Kylo Ren is on before he goes on to Starkiller Base.
Right.
And so the other ships are... You have Rey's speeder, you have the TIE fighters, you have Poe's X-Wing, the Resistance transport. You have some random things. I do want to make a point about two ships that were kind of fascinating to see, actually, in this book. One is the snow speeder that the snow troopers use, which we discussed a few episodes back in the deleted scenes because it's not in the theatrical version. And the other ship that is really fascinating is the quad jumper.
I was going to ask you, do they cover the quad jumper?
Yes.
Which is in Disney Infinity.
Rest
in peace.
Moment of silence.
Yes.
So the quad jumper, it's really what this ship is, even though we don't see it flying around at all, but clearly it's better than some garbage, is that... in Ray's mind, is that it's really meant as like a cargo hauler.
Hmm.
But so it's a ship that's actually pretty powerful and can lug, huge cargo and so forth.
Okay. I never knew what a quad jumper was.
Yeah. The random facts that it actually tells you in this book is that it's owned by someone else that Unker Plutt is trying to buy it from. Mm-hmm. When it gets blown up, Unker Plutt was trying to buy it, so he actually doesn't lose anything. But I feel bad for the merchants who are trying to sell it to him.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah.
Did it belong to like Baba Joe?
Did not belong to the Crittermonger, no.
So what age range would you say this book is good for?
At it, I'm thinking like 40 and over.
Right.
For it might be slightly older than the character encyclopedia. It's still... Mm-hmm. Obviously, teenagers, it's great for, and up. Teenagers and up, great. Even,
right.
7 to 10, maybe as low as 6 could still read it.
If you have a 6-year-old, you might not want to put it on your coffee table.
That too.
And one last thing. Does it go into how the First Order TIE fighters are better than the Imperial TIE fighters?
It definitely does. Oh, yeah.
Give us a little bit of that.
I don't remember exactly, but some of it has to do with the powering and the shields. And the Special Forces version is even more powerful. And and the Special Forces one is the one that can seat two people, like the one that Poe and Finn escape on.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they take a Special Forces TIE fighter, right, and not just a regular one that can only seat one pilot.
That fact I did not know until I read the Force Awakens novelization, where they specifically say this is a Special Forces TIE fighter.
Now, in your opinion, what would win in a battle? Imperial TIE fighter, New Order TIE fighter, or the Kenner TIE fighter? Circa 1978.
I would imagine the special for the, you know, the First Order.
That's wrong. That's wrong. Kenner TIE fighter is always going to win. Reason unexplained.
Okay.
Just take it at face value.
Okay.
All right. Well, did you have any last thoughts on this book? And would you put it on your coffee table?
Well, yes, I would put it on my coffee table, especially since for a lot of people who are sort of casual Star Wars fans and have seen the movie, they might be interested in finding out this or that ship. So I would say yes, I will be putting it on my coffee table. The one thing I didn't mention, which was really fascinating, so I mentioned how the finalizer had those two open flaps, which is just like really massive and really gives you a sense of how gigantic it is. But one of the last pages is actually has all 13 of these vehicles and shows you size comparisons and shows you how utterly massive the finalizer is compared to any of these other ships. And then even the Millennium Falcon, the cargo hauler that Han and Chewbacca have is pretty large, but it's like tiny compared to the finalizer. And then obviously the smallest thing on there is Rey's speeder, but it really gives you a sense of how everything is in comparison.
What about Starkiller Base?
It's not in there.
Huh.
Yeah, I guess because it's not a ship per se. Yeah, it's a planet.
But you'd think that would be like one thing they'd want to put in there.
Yeah.
One thing I really want to find out.
I know.
Unless they just.
Like, how does this work?
Unless it merits its own separate book. I don't know. It's so massive.
Huh. Well, we do want to say that, Drew, you have been writing up these reviews for us on skywalkingthroughneverland.com. So please, if you want to read about it, like if you're a reader of reviews more than a listener, please head to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and check out your reviews. And you've posted pictures with them of the books. Mm-hmm. So it's really interesting. And we appreciate you doing that for us.
Absolutely.
Oh, one last question.
Yeah.
Leia's transport that she comes down to Takadana. Does that fly sideways? It just seems so impractical.
Sort of. It's what it talks about is that it's cobbled together from different parts. So there's like a B-wing cockpit in there.
Really?
Yeah. Really? Yeah. And they have like sort of twin engines and it does kind of fly awkwardly.
Yeah.
But the reason is because the resistance, their financial resources are not as ample as anybody else. So they just sort of have to make do with what they have.
Right. But you would just think it would just be so air resistant, just because of the nature that it flies sideways, and why not just turn it around? You can get better wind resistance.
Yeah.
Not that there's much wind in space.
Yeah.
All right, now before we wrap things up, tell everyone how they can get a hold of you and all your other blogs.
Great, thank you. So I blog about Star Wars at starwarsmaven.info. Twitter at Star Wars Maven, Instagram at Star Wars Maven, and I also, you know, write about this stuff, and it's great.
Yeah. Thank you, Drew, for joining us. Our Skywalking Through Neverland book analyst.
Yes.
Unless any other Skywalkers can come up with a better name.
Ooh. Yeah.
We've already gone through Jocasta New, but he doesn't look that much like Jocasta New.
No. Right.
Plus, he's not really a librarian, so we're up for name grabs here.
Yes. Yes.
So, all right, so tweet at us.
At Skywalking Pod.
And there we go.
Awesome.
That wraps up episode 121 of
Skywalking Through Neverland.
We would like to thank Trisha Barr,
Rick and Eliza Peralta,
Mark Daniel,
and Drew Kaplan for joining us this week. Now, like I was saying earlier, next week we have someone really special lined up. Someone I've wanted to talk to since I was 4 years old.
What?
And now because of Skywalking Through Neverland, I have this opportunity. I am so excited. I talked to this person yesterday on the phone. She has a little pre-interview. I am so excited. Who is it? Do you want to know?
You'll find out in 1 week. How's that for a tease?
Nice. Yeah, for more great Star Wars and pop culture podcasts, you can go to RetroZap.com, where you can find shows like Brews and Blasters,
Techno Retro Dads,
We Know Nothing, which is a Game of Thrones podcast,
Blobba the Hutt, and I have on good authority that Jamie has been to several of the shooting locations for Episode 8.
Oh, nice. Mm-hmm. And Talking Apes TV, which was just released this week, where our special guests are Ken Mills from Zilch E Monkeys Podcast and Adam O'Brien from the Jogcast Radio Network.
And you know what? I'm like halfway through that show. It's really fun. I love your interview episodes because, once again, you know, you bring your interviewing skills to that show. And even if you're not that into Planet of the Apes like me, it was still very, very enjoyable.
That's our goal. Even if you're not into apes, you'll still have a lot of fun listening to us argue and banter and know that I'm right over Mark.
So head to RetroZap.com where you can catch all of those shows. Now, this is a reminder to you, we are now on the Google Play Music app on your Android phone. If you are an Android user, this is a great app to use. Talking Apes TV is on there, Skywalking Through Neverland is on there, and Fangirls Going Rogue is on there. I made sure that all those shows that we're involved in are on that Google Play Music app. And all of you who took advantage of the Tee Public sale this month, thank you so much. We had a lot of shirts flying off the shelves, so we appreciate that. Our BB-8 tees. You can also get them any time of year. Just head to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and click on the Support Us tab. And there you can find your link to Tee Public.
I'm going to put you on the spot here. How's the new BB-8 at the beach shirt coming along?
I'm still learning my pen. So
I gave you 1,000 ideas.
I know you did. You know what? I've been rolling out Talking Apes TV.
Okay, fine.
There you go.
Fine. Point taken.
That's right. Okay, Skywalkers. Well, you can reach us anytime on social media. We are at Skywalking Pod for most of our social media. So that's Twitter, Instagram, Periscope, and Snapchat. And if you were paying attention on Snapchat last week, when I rolled out episode 120, I kind of did a Snapchat story so you could kind of see behind the scenes. Why are you laughing at me?
Snapchat.
I know. Everyone's using it, though. Like, even when we were talking, we were waiting in line to talk with, what's his name at the event? Singer dude?
Oh, Gene Simmons.
Yes, when we were waiting to talk with Gene Simmons, we saw a woman, like, hold up her phone and do the little Snapchat thing.
I'm sure we did.
Yes. I did, anyway. I notice it more and more now. And people are doing that on red carpets as well. Like, the Ellen show is really fun to follow on Snapchat because you have, like, all this behind-the-scenes
stuff. Why not just Periscope it or record it and release that video?
It's just a new thing. It's a new thing. I don't know. So I try it, you know, at least once a week I try to use it. So.
Okay.
All right. So add me, Skywalking Pod. Yes.
Now, what I'm more interested in is iTunes reviews. So
yeah.
Please, if you haven't already, it would be greatly appreciated if you left a review. Leave us as many stars as you want. Mm-hmm. And just let us know what you think about the show. Because once again, it really helps boost the notoriety on iTunes when you have a lot of reviews.
Yeah.
And plus, we just want to know what you guys think.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Is there anything we should change? Like, let us know. You know, we're always trying to improve.
Yeah, let us know what you like about the show and maybe a segment you may not like, or just tell us what you think overall. We're here to listen.
All right. Well, with that,
is there anything more to be said?
I think there's one more thing you should always remember.
To tune in to episode 122 for our special guest.
And
never land on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Augushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said. All right, and here we go.
Okay. All right, you guys. So I guess we'll just jump right into it here.
Yeah, it's pretty much self-explanatory. We're looking forward to Star Wars Celebration.
Anaheim in Europe.
And Europe.
Yeah. Anaheim. I mean, I Orlando. Oh, oh.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
Only over Anaheim.
All right, I'll have to watch that. All right, I've pressed record, so we are going to start recording our wrap. We're going to start recording our wraparounds for episode 121.
I never
Uh-oh. Go time, yes.
I never
yes.
have to cough until we're ready
until
to record.
Until I press go. Now, how do you say presumption? Oh.
You thought you were going to get me, but you're going down.
Okay, how do you say tangential?
Presumptuous.
No, how do you say presumptuous?
Presumptuous. Tangential. Oh, I missed the joke there. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, those that's performers true. Say, just walk out there and do it. It's like, then you're not doing it right. Mm-hmm. If you don't have any kind of flop sweat, then guess again. All right. All right. With that, let's hodo. Yeah. And now, that's for the bloopers.
Yep. So, Amy.
Not so easy, is it? All right. Drew, go.
Hello.
Drew, this is live. Okay. This is live, Drew.
Well, hello. Thank you for having me back. Thank you for having me back, Richard and Sarah.
All right, we'll roll into this.
We're just kidding.
Yeah.
Okay. Wait. Oh, okay.
You're the host.
Yeah.
Try to get beyond all that. All right. Here
am
we
I
go.
Saying, what are you saying? What am I saying?
You're saying the...
bold?
Yeah, the bold.
Oh, wow. Nice.
But you posted in our Skywalker of the Week... I'm sorry. Meh. Totally missed. Okay. We weren't recording all That's of good. That.
Take three.
It was a good practice run. It was a good practice.
Right? All right? Okay.
Ready?
Holy
Here we
buckets.
Go.
Was that an okay start?
That was perfect.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, that was good. Yeah. All right. Well, let's go into what some of our Skywalk... Blah. How do we get on with our day? I don't know how to leave.
Well, we can always say this. It's quesadilla time.
What? Fajita time.
It's fajita time. But you know where we're not going to have fajitas or quesadillas? On Alderaan. Do you know why? Because you should never.
Okay, look, can we record one more outro? Sure. That was weird. All right.
What was wrong with that?
It was fine. I just want to try one more.
Okay, sure.
All right. Four reviews last month. Let's see. So thank you for your iTunes reviews. I don't know where to go from here.